Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. We are live. We are broadcasting worldwide. And we have a special guest, a highly decorated military veteran who's also an artist and a Second Amendment activist joining us, coming up in studio in the third hour to get the perspective of a veteran on the world today. Met Mario Lopez down in San Antonio at the open carry rally at the Alamo, and he lost an arm. Most of the flesh off his face and an eye and an IED. That's not why we're having him on. He's an amazing artist, and just his story of adversity and fighting through it is buoying to my heart, and I think it will be to yours as well. So that is coming up, and he will be in studio with us today in the third hour. For the balance of the transmission, the first 2 hours, we will be taking your phone calls. Covering the news, Mancow said his phone died, the battery died when we went to break, and so he'll finish his story. The real reason I got him on was not the $9.5 million buy-off plan to go to a pro-Obama radio show. The real reason I wanted to have him on was talking to a major Hollywood star who personally knew Obama and actually lived with him for years, he was saying. And so that's some real intel there. And we want to get him back on to talk about that a little bit for about 5-10 minutes at the bottom of the hour to finish the rest of the story. Obviously, it's just an overload of news. We declared a semi-victory yesterday when the Seattle Police Department that put in NSA spy boxes hooked into the federal government via the threat fusion centers, we declared a semi-victory that they had at least said, okay, we're going to turn off these devices while the city council looks at it, because the council never even authorized them to be turned on. It was a grant last year. The system's being put in right now. The city wanted to review it to find out what it's doing, if it's violating privacy. The police, of course, under Homeland, had it on. That's what it's all about. It's about the bureaucracy doing whatever it wants, totally illegally, just like the DEA is in all the NSA data system spying on Americans without warrants and then using it in court. It's all completely illegal. It's all completely selectively enforced. It is the people that run this country that ship in the vast majority of the narcotics. They're the same big banks that own the military industrial complex, that own the big insurance complex, that own the big pharma complex. They push the legal and the illegal drugs on you. And I would just advise young people, never get on any of it, including coffee. Because once you get addicted to something, it's not fun. I'm addicted to coffee. I've battled tobacco my whole life. Haven't had any tobacco other than, I think, a couple cigars the last 3.5 years. And I'm always on and off pipes, cigarettes, chewing tobacco. If it grows on a tobacco plant, I want to put it in my body. But the issue is that imagine this is the modern slavery. They put out these chemicals. They put out these plants that have always been there, that people have been using forever, that in the 20s and 30s you could buy at any drugstore. You could send a five-year-old in to buy a box of cocaine or a box of opium, a bottle of opium. Then they make it illegal. It puts all this money into it. It creates a huge crime culture, corrupts the police. Well, yeah, when did they get rid of prohibition? 1930s, early 1930s. When did they make all the other drugs illegal? Right then, they needed a new business. The only reason I'm concerned about getting rid of the drug war is that you've got such a criminal culture now that the criminals will go to other things. We know this from countries that have decriminalized. It's made crime drop massively, except for a few things. Kidnapping and stuff. But doesn't matter. Justice be done, may the heavens fall. Big Obamacare news, big military news, big NSA news. It's all coming up, but I'll finish up with the fact that the police did not turn the Wi-Fi system off. Of course not. Ladies and gentlemen, it's already Thursday, the 14th day of November, 2013. I am your host, Alex Jones. We're going to be here live for the next 3 hours. President Obama is giving a press conference slash speech yet again, selling the propaganda that is the Obamanation care, the scam care. Now, going over the latest on Obamacare here today, businesses cut full-time workers to meet Obamacare mandate. Study finds Christian Science Monitor. Oh, really? It was written to lower wages and incentivize part-time because the globalists want a poor population. That's a set Agenda 21 UN official policy is to make you poor and a renter. Let's continue. I know you've heard this 1,000 times here, but now it's happening in mass. Public college cites high cost of Obamacare in canceling students' health plans. It goes on. And now Obama is out giving a speech. Here. Let's hear some of the latest lies that he's reading off of a teleprompter.
Help you bring down the costs.
Oh.
So, if you received one of these letters, I'd encourage you to take a look at the marketplace. Even if the website isn't working as smoothly as it should be for everybody yet,
as smoothly as it should be,
the plan comparison tool that lets you browse costs for new plans near you is working just fine.
Oh, it's working just fine.
This fix won't solve every problem.
Go to one of our navigators. We'll enroll you in the Democratic Party and anti-gun groups.
It's going to help a lot of people. Doing more will require work with Congress. And I've said from the beginning, I'm willing to work with Democrats and Republicans to fix problems as they arise. This is an example of what I was talking about. We can always make this law work better. It is important to understand, though, that the old individual market was not working well. And it's important that we don't pretend that somehow that's a place worth going back to. Too often it works fine as long as you stay healthy. It doesn't work well when you're sick.
All right, let's stop right there. We'll go back to it in a minute. Ladies and gentlemen, we had the lowest cost on record, highest quality health care in the world 50 years ago on record. That's on record. All the royalty of the planet, Saudi Arabian, British, Dutch, Japanese, they all came here. Lowest cost, highest quality. Let me say that again. Lowest cost, highest quality, quickest delivery. Lowest cost, highest quality, quickest delivery. On record. Government got involved with select mega corporations and big banks that got into the insurance business and wrote regulations and set things into the markets to control and monopolize the markets and to then introduce government money into the markets, Medicare, Medicaid, and other systems that now drove up the price, just like education. We had the highest quality education in the world on average, one of the highest college graduation rates, the highest physical IQs, the most inventions until the 70s. Okay? America was the longest lived on average. America was the biggest savers on average. We were the most wealthy on average. We were 4%. Out of 100 of the world population, and we had half the wealth. We've lost almost all of that now. Globalism is a curse. Globalism is insider groups robbing everyone. So they wreck the old system and then give you something 10 times worse. It's probably 20 times worse. And then they're going to, as I told you, write new laws to make it even worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And by then, Obama the puppet will be long gone. And you'll be under globalist, fascist death care. Let's go back and hear what this literal foreign agent, here to sell the trendy TV-watching public. Hey, he's got a neat suit. He's a Harvard lawyer. You know, he's half black. This must mean there's a difference. No, the same mega banks, the same old evil white men are the ones running things who've got everybody black and white at the ground level fighting with each other. And it's the ultimate joke to them to put up Obama, and it's been a devastating victory. He has been incredibly successful. He has been the most successful tyrant of the 20th century, the 21st century. There were other tyrants that were very successful in the 20th. He is, undoubtedly, Obama, I'm giving him this title now, is the most successful tyrant, liar, con artist, fraudster, fake idea, Madison Avenue manufactured propaganda coup d'etat that has been around in the 13, almost 14 years that is the 21st century. Let's go back to the pure manifestation of an actor reading off a teleprompter selling you total betrayal. Here is the con artist in chief.
And, you know, regardless of what Congress does, ultimately I'm the President of the United States, and they expect me to do something about it. So, in terms of how I intend to approach it, I'm just going to keep on working as hard as I can around the priorities that the American people care about. And I think it's legitimate for them to expect me to have to win back some credibility on this health care law in particular, and on a whole range of these issues in general. And, you know, that's on me. I mean, we fumbled the rollout on this health care law.
Told you, folks.
There are a whole bunch of things about it that are working really well.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Which people didn't notice.
Like saying brain cancer is working really well.
Because they weren't controversial. So making sure kids could stay on their parents' plans till they were up through the age of 25.
But the parents get thrown off the plan,
sure
you lying sack of crap.
Got more discounts on their prescription drugs. There were a whole bunch of stuff that we did well over the first 3 years. But we always knew that these marketplaces creating a place where people can shop.
All right, that's enough.
And through
they always knew that it basically increased the price the last 3 years by around 50% before it even kicked in. It got rid of the laws blocking insurance companies from stopping competition. And now it's ended a bunch of competition. It's made 50 million people, not 35 million, go out and get insurance. It's going to kick another 52 million off of it. And it is the greatest criminal transfer of wealth I've ever seen, not even to a government, but to these big banks. And you have to understand, folks, we've got to get out of the system to not have things collapse. It's designed to collapse in a stepping fashion. And I told you, first Sebelius would fall on her sword when this came out. Then Obamacare would fall on his sword and say, it's my fault. The buck stops with me, because it came out even in the Associated Press 2 weeks ago. That guy searched this. I want to show TV viewers. Insurance companies warn Obama not to scale back Obamacare was the headline. And they were actually in their big consortium lobbying group issuing a public statement saying, listen, buddy, fall on that sword, take the blame, claim it's the computer not working, because they need to blame the computer not working. It's working, folks. It's designed to kick you off your plan. It's designed to create a pool of people who they have your ID to then make you get insurance at double, triple, quadruple, or even above that. Some people are paying 700% more. On average, it's 200% more. Humana in Texas, 539% increase on families with no pre-existing conditions, doesn't cover pre-existing conditions. This is a wish list of the most bloodthirsty, vicious insurance companies the world has ever seen. The ones that took over our healthcare and screwed it over. And the poor average Democrat goes, man, healthcare is like half my paycheck, or I can't get healthcare, or this is a scam, this is screwed up. This is, and the government's like, we got a plan, just go along with this, you're really going to love it. And now it hits you like a freight train, and they're going to, this is how they do it, folks. Because they've learned in psych warfare that if you create a process and just stall things, people then become accepting of it. This is their main philosophy, their main system of doing this. And I'm like a football coach that's been watching these people for 20-something years and knows all their plays and moves, and the general public doesn't even know the game. They don't even know it's a game. And that's why we're here, folks, is to tell you how the scams work. Because listen, once you're aware of this stuff, you would cry at how obvious it is if you're a new listener. I know there's a thousand flavors of media and all this disinfo out there and the rest of it. Folks, there's a real globalist system. They've carried it out in hundreds of other countries. We know their plan. We know their moves. We know their plays. We know their mindset. We know their criminology. We know their modus operandi. We know who their daddy is. We know who the great-granddaddy is. We know who the great-great-granddaddy is, literally. We know the families. We know the banks. We know the players. We know it all. See, you're an expert on football or soap operas, or you're an expert on rock and roll or hip-hop or Catholic saints or whatever it is you're into, or baseball scores. I'm an expert on world government combines and their public plan to set up a world government to incrementally turn off your resources until you're fully dependent, to put soft kill, slow kill poisons in the food and water where you're so brain damaged, and I am too, that you're unable to fight back and you roll over and die. You're in an incremental, super technocracy, hyper eugenics warfare plan adopted by Hitler from the British that he planned to carry out as part of Lebensraum, or living space, when he took over the world. You are under a soft kill, weaponized program. Total warfare, total siege, no holds barred. There it is, insurers warn of overhaul-induced sticker shock. That's AP, and they go and warn Obama, you better not back off on this. You're going to let us tax every American offshore. Fall on your sword, Obama. Alex Jones here, and I want to tell you, Obama is saying that he wasn't informed that the website didn't work until days into the crisis. But they say someday it's going to work. And, of course, the website being broken is a distraction from the rates doubling, tripling, quadrupling, or more. And people being kicked off their plans by the tens of millions, set to be 50-plus million, according to McClatchy. All of this is unfolding. All of this is happening. And then you look at it, businesses cut full-time workers, Christian Science Monitor, Wired Magazine, public colleges cite high cost of Obamacare and canceling student health plans. We've got all these reports, ladies and gentlemen. Vulnerable Dems scramble to keep distance from Obamacare. That's out of the Hill. What do you mean scrambling to get your distance from it? I mean, you should all be proud of it. The Republican rhinos, John McCain and Boehner, and all of them should be very proud. I mean, they work for the same foreign banks. I mean, this is Republicans helped write this. And Democrats would snicker at me and say, shut up, right-winger. We're getting our free health care. You're just mad because your time's over. Socialism, our time has come. I was like, oh, yeah, I'm sure the ultra-rich really want to give you something for free because they care about you, dummy. Here's another one. 10 Senate Dems who should apologize for Obamacare. They shouldn't apologize. They should be recalled. They should be impeached. Mary Landrieu, Kay Hagan, Mark Begich. Oh, yeah, he's a piece of work. You know, I know his brother. Michael Bennett, Patty Murray, Tom Harkin, Chuck Schumer, Dick Durbin, Harry Reid, Max Baucus. No. Their people will double down even more support because they love, losers love being gamed. Losers love being treated like trash. They don't like being treated good. They don't like being given a fair shake. They don't like being treated lovingly and honorably. They want to be abused. They don't want to be free. They want to be slovenly and domesticated and imagine that they're part of a power structure by supporting it. They are the ultimate useful idiots, the ultimate chumps, schmucks, fools, marks, just absolutely pathetic. And all of you mainline Republicans that keep supporting this as well, you are helping destroy this country as well. Good job. Being naive, denying how criminal the system is, ignoring what the founders said, you're going to lose everything because you think you're part of the establishment. White House is trying to salvage Obamacare. Democrats are in distress. Well, it doesn't matter. They'll just put in Chris Christie's. They'll just put in that anti-gun, open border promoting piece of trash that the Republican leadership promotes. Might as well have Obama for a third term. At least we all know he's a liar. It'll take a few years to figure out that self-propelled creature That self-propelled blob. Christie's. Oh, look, Nancy Pelosi says Obama to propose health fix. He's given the speech right now. He's going to fix it. And you notice he said in his speech over and over again, he said, it stops with me. I take the blame. Because he's been told, listen, we'll prop you up, but we're going to politically destroy you for now. We'll rebuild you later. You can be just like Bill Clinton and get $100 million of money saying it's for Haitian kids and keep all of it for, you know, your $5 million trips with private jets. But let me explain how this works. You say it's your fault, period. And you don't get rid of it. That's why the Republican leadership's like, looks like we can't change Obamacare. You notice you're hearing that. People are like, why not? Why aren't there bigger hearings? Why aren't people getting in trouble? Where's the impeachment? Because they're all part of the same club. And they want to just blame Obozo. It goes on and on, ladies and gentlemen, the Obamacare fairy tale. But people like fairy tales. You're not supposed to tell little kids. I've had people tell me that I shouldn't tell my kids. I've been walking by an open-air Santa Claus. This happened several times. And, ho, come over, kids. And my kids go, Santa isn't real. When they were like 3 years old, it happened with my son, Rex. And people are like, you shouldn't have told him that. I'm just like, what am I lying? Say some guy in a red suit comes down the chimney? You know, they've had cases of kids that climb up on the roof by a ladder and go down the chimney and die, really thinking they're going to go down the chimney. Sometimes when there's a fire going in it, they've had cases of that. And, you know, it's the same thing. I mean, look, listen, big government is meant to abuse you. Big government is meant by predatory groups to destroy you. And historically, it delivers nothing but poverty and patheticness. But all of you out there think that you succeed in life by the government getting bigger. I'm talking to government people, government minions. You're going to find out, just like North Korea, that it leads to hell. We'll be right back with intel on Obama. Has come out and pushed a whole nother bucket of lies in a 30-minute speech and supposed press conference to the state-run media lapdogs. We're going to be breaking that down. Also, huge developments on the NSA front. On Infowars.com, the police illegally turned on a Homeland Security system that grabs everybody's data. It's really going in nationwide. It is illegal, and we sourced in articles 3 days ago on Monday, 3.5 days ago, how it was illegal. And so the next day, the police announced, because of the city council freaking out in Seattle, that they were going to be ordering that turned off. It wasn't supposed to be turned on. And the police said, okay, we've turned it off. Well, the news has gone out and checked it. It has not been turned off. So, again, just a wall of government deception. And they all lie now, basically, and deceive at the mid and high levels. There are some good people in government, but the captainship, the commandership, the masters and commanders of the ship of state and major corporations lie as a matter of course militarily. Against us. That's a military tactic. We're going to be breaking that down, getting into huge amnesty news, huge news on so many fronts. But I wanted to get Eric Mankell Mueller, syndicated radio host, Fox host, a hit show on History Channel with his brother, Mark Mueller, God, Guns, and Automobiles, has other big TV shows in development. You know, we had him on yesterday. I noticed on Infowars.com and on the YouTube video that went up this morning, a minority of commenters were like, this guy didn't get offered $9.5 million for a three-year contract for another radio show. That's not even that much for a three-year contract, folks, for those that don't know. And, you know, they're the media. Obama's not trying to buy people off. You know, he didn't get an offer to go not bash the political system. Folks, I've gotten those offers. It's all over the news they're buying off the media through corporate conduits. And Mankell has made that type of money, I happen to know, he didn't like to brag, in a year in the past when talk radio wasn't collapsing. You know, back in years like 1998, years like that during the tech boom. I know what went on in radio back then, folks. I know all about it because I've been in it for 18 years, and I work with a small network that doesn't censor me, so I'm paid basically nothing by the GCN radio network. I want to point this out here, give you some inside baseball. That's why I have my own advertisement, my own product. That's how I funded this whole media operation. Nobody else does it the way I do it. I invented this to be able to get the word out by trial and error, but that's a side issue. I want to point out that it took a lot for him to come on air and talk about that yesterday, and that he had a lot of courage. That's why we got him on, because he told me about it, and I said, do you have the will to tell that on air? And he did tell that on air. And then you've got fools out there that don't know that Rush Limbaugh makes $45 million a year, that Glenn Beck profits and keeps over $100 million a year. That people like Michael Savage make incredible amounts of money. They just don't know. So instead of saying, wow, what a hero for saying no to all that money, people say, oh, Mancow's making that up. Well, I'll tell you what he's not making up, because this will all go on record right now. And I know he's telling the truth, because I've had those exact same offers. Harry Lennox, and that's why I got him back on the show. He's got to go, so it's a brief interview. Mancow.com, you can follow him on Twitter. We'll put that up on screen for TV viewers, and I'll give it out to radio listeners. I'm a fan of Harry Lennox just when I've seen him in movies and stuff. He's a very good actor. And it turns out he's basically the same age as Obama and is really good, had been friends with Obama and basically lived with Obama, is how he put it. Might as well have lived with him was the words he said to Mancow. He came on Mancow's show, but he got a chance to talk to him off air. And, of course, he's now the hit actor on Blacklist. But he joins us to break down this inside intel on what he said behind the scenes about Obama. So, Mancow, thank you so much for coming on with us today. And repeat what you said on your radio show to me about Harry Lennox. We'll put Harry Lennox up on screen for folks that may not recognize the name. Go ahead.
Alex, look, I do want to say MSNBC and all of these people are dying. Your model is a brilliant model for the future. Someday I want to come on and tell you the truth about Glenn Beck. I actually know the truth that nobody else knows. It is somewhat heartbreaking when you reveal these things, and of course you're dealing with morons that don't know, and they go, no. They want to believe the Matrix. And I understand it. They still want to believe the hope and change. They want to believe Obamacare. Look, I sold my condo, and the politician today said, in Chicago, I just couldn't handle the taxes and the hassle. It's such a hassle to live in Obama's town of Chicago.
Yeah, they're doubling the property taxes, even though property value's down in Chicagoland.
Yeah. But somebody said to me today, a politician, Jack Franks, you can look up who he is. I think he's one of the good ones. But he said to me, he goes, Mancow, thank God you sold your condo. Because now every house and condo that sells, 5% of every sale in America has to go to Obamacare. And I said, oh, that's a joke. He goes, no, it's true. Is that true, Alex?
No, that is in the bill. In fact, I actually have an article about it right here. I'm glad you mentioned that. Go ahead.
But can you believe that? And I want to say something else to the people. Look, I would put Alex on, and I don't give a hairy rat's ass anymore. The asses are masses. The masses are asses. And they voted for Obama twice, so. I don't care what people think of me. I just don't care. But Alex, I made fun of you. We laughed at you. We had a good laugh at your expense. I thought you were insane. Drones in American skies, never. Light posts that would listen to us, never. The white boxes that are all over in England that are listening and gathering data, ridiculous. Blimps in the sky. I really thought you were a jackass. And boy, brother, you were the canary in the coal mine. So there you go. It's funny how none of us, when you're right, nobody ever says it, do they? It's all knee-slapping hilarious when you're saying some of these things. But my God, man, I wish you were wrong. I really do.
I wish that too, brother, every day.
And I do too. You know what, Alex? I really do. I wish I was wrong. I wish I didn't see it. Ignorance is bliss. I really wish I was hope and change, and isn't it great that Acorn's making millions to bamboozle people? I wish I was one of these fools. I often wonder, seriously, instead of toiling and worrying about my children, if I wouldn't just be better with my fat diabetic foot being cut off by Obamacare, with my Obama phone and everything taken care of. Actor Harry Lennox came in. This is earth-shattering, earth-shaking. And I want to tell you, I get discouraged. I don't have to work. I sometimes want to walk away. I met a man named Jay Farrow, very cutting-edge comedian from SNL. Brilliant, beautiful human being. It renews me. You get cynical. You meet these jagoffs, these jerks. Harry Lennox comes in at a low point. I was ready to pull the plug. This guy is the star of The Blacklist, the number one hottest new show on TV with James Spader. He was, many will remember, he was the general in Superman. He's a top, maybe the top African-American Shakespearean actor. He's got a version of Henry V coming out. So he's leaving my studio, and he sees a cutout we have of Obama. And he says, well, he's a rat bastard. And I said, what? He goes, oh, because I'm black, I have to like Obama. And we're laughing. I mean, he's the guy's a wonderful human being. He starts laughing. And we're kind of kidding a little. And he says, man, Cal, do I remind you of him? And I said, well, I don't want to say anything. He goes, oh, yeah, because all black people are the same. And he's laughing some more. He goes, man, Cal, Barack Obama is me. He goes, you've seen me on TV. You've seen me in movies. He is me. And I said, what are you talking about? What are you saying? He goes, do I remind you of Obama? And I said, well, yeah, you do. He goes, he mimicked me. He followed me for years. And they wanted me to train him and teach him how to act. This is Harry Lennox's words. I've got some of my crew here. Please correct me if I'm wrong. And what was the word? Like an educated Southside educated African American.
Put your crew member as a witness on. This is national news. Put him on.
Okay.
Which this crew member is it?
It's the guy's name's Nathan. He's one of my producers. Here you go. Oh, sir.
Nathan, this was during a break. Tell us what Lennox said.
Yeah, so exactly what Mankow said. He called me, Barack Obama. He said, that guy's a rat bastard. He mimed me for years. I trained him to be a Southside educated African American black man from Chicago. Exactly what Mankow said. And he was taught to act like Barack Obama. Or Harry Lennox was taught Barack Obama.
And it's on record. I looked this up when Mankow told me this yesterday, that they are friends and knew each other for years.
That's right. He says he's known him since 1992, spent many hours with him at his house, talking for hours. He says the only person that knows him better than him would be Michelle Obama.
Unbelievable. And he went on to say that he's a rat bastard. And amazing. Tell folks, thanks for talking to us. Please put Mankow back
sir.
On. Thank you. Show Mankow, this is at the end of the interview. He's leaving or during a break.
Alex, I hate you bringing this guy into it because, you know, now he's going to get audited. You and I get attacked every year. I get audited illegally every year. They've never gotten one dime. And also, you have to understand something. Harry Lennox has to work in Hollywood. And I really love the guy, and I hope I don't get him in trouble by revealing this. But he did say, I know him. Probably only Michelle knows him better than I do. And he said he's very stupid. He's been taught to act like this. And I said, here's the thing that I want to me, this is the bomb.
Bring up the CIA stuff. Yeah, bring that up.
Well, I CIA, brother, I don't know CIA.
No. Tell me what you told me. But, I mean, get into the fact that you're saying he knew he would be president forever. I mean, repeat what you told me off air.
Well, you just stole my thunder.
Well, go ahead, say it.
No, look, I said, how long did he know he was going to be president? He said, well, he knew from 1998. And I said, from childhood? He goes, I don't know. I said, but definitely 98. He goes, and maybe earlier. Now, this is a man that hadn't done anything. And Alex, you and I talk about this. Do I have time, or are you going to cut
me
off?
Yes, you got time. Do it.
Okay. Folks, you know, I understand people. You know, you hate George W. Bush, but then the people that love Obama and he does all the same stuff, I don't care if people hate Obama or hate Bush, right? As long as they're intellectually honest. This party-first Nazi attitude, you know, well, yeah, they're rounded up my neighbors that I love, but I'm part of the party. This party-first attitude frightens me. I just want people, you can hate me, you can hate Alex, you can love Obama, you can hate Bush, you can hate whatever. But I just want you to be honest with yourself. Have you known anyone? I think of my friend Rusty Humphreys, whose dad was killed in Vietnam. Here's a couple of little, you know, blurry pictures. Anyone in your family, anybody you've ever known that went to Vietnam, they had a couple. I mean, think of what the technology was. And yet John Kerry had film crews. John Kerry was a nobody. John Kerry has color footage of him fighting in Vietnam. The boy from Hope, Arkansas, from a divorced family, a nobody. Bill Clinton has pictures as a child of him hanging out with JFK. Dwight D. Eisenhower's granddaughter told me that these people know from birth. I think of the boys from Brazil, that old movie, but whatever. I just wonder, Obama knew in 98 he was going to be president. Who are you, Alex? You claim to know. You've been right on so much. I don't know. I don't have any clue.
100% Bill Clinton was a CIA project. He is the son of the former governor, the Rockefeller governor. His mother was a lady of the night. They decided to have the baby. That's why he's broken down and cried on TV and said there were only two people that thought he could be president in 1962 when he met Kennedy, and that was his mama and David Rockefeller. Thank you, David Rockefeller. And he broke down and cried because, you know, the Rockefellers took care of him because he was an illegitimate child of the family. He was then put into a CIA program in high school. He then became one of the head CIA people by the late 60s. Under the CIA section chief, we have the names with Hillary, in England. And then he was sent to Russia as a deep cover spy. He's been CIA since high school, at least. Same thing with Obama, his mother, his grandfather, his mother. That's all been partially declassified.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
It is amazing that Bill Clinton was hanging out in Russia when he was. But anyway, look, Alex, I don't know. I don't know who's picking these people. But it does seem scripted. It does seem like, I mean, look, everything that Bush did, and you can play all the audio, everything that Bush did, Obama's doing. So no matter how we vote, we get more of them. And I mean the government. I mean,
and look at Bush
Sr.,
head of the CIA. Look at Bush Jr., clearly was in the CIA earlier. And all of this is how they put in, just like foreign governments used to try to bring people into a country, get them to run for president or prime minister later to infiltrate. That's why we have rules against foreign-born being president here, like Schwarzenegger. It's the same thing, but this is a corporate, long-term strategic takeover plan.
Brother, like everything else you say, I hope it's not true. I'd like to think that any child can be born an American. And if he does it right, he can be president. I don't know.
Sure, but let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Lennox, yeah. Rising actor, top actor on TV, movies, great actor. Why do you think he started off air talking so much trash about Obama?
Well, you know what, Alex? The show was over. I don't know that. I didn't know the man. And I want to tell you, he's one of the finest human beings I've ever met in my life. I don't know that he wouldn't have talked about it on air. And I hope I'm not violating a confidence. But look, this guy walked out and said it in front of my whole staff.
Hey, I would have said this is off record. Exactly. He should have said that, so it's on record.
Well, and look, I have, you know, my show's broadcast on TV in Chicago.
There are TV cameras in the studio, yeah.
We're at the Fox Studios in Chicago, right on Michigan Avenue. I mean, I had camera people, producers, four or five people. We stood around and we listened to them. I don't think I'm violating the confidence. I hope I don't hurt the man. I think the blacklist is the great. I don't like you. I don't like any of this mainstream TV. I happen to like the blacklist a great deal. I don't want to hurt the man, but he did say it. He did. And if you watch the guy, it's funny. I mean, he is Obama. And he says Obama's a nothing. Alex, I've spent time with Obama. I spent time with Obama before he was anybody. And there's nothing there. Look, I can explain to everybody who Obama is. If you give me 30 seconds, I'll explain it.
Do it.
Okay. I dated a girl that was severely abused by several stepdads. She was molested. She was abandoned. And she was whatever you wanted her to be. Okay. And what I mean by that is it's a defense mechanism. I think Obama probably had a miserable childhood, and he's a nothing. There was no father. There was the mother that abandoned him. She was chasing after, you know, so much has been hidden about her, but she was, it wouldn't have been too hard to sleep with her.
No. His mother was in porn.
So So she was dumped off in Kansas.
Tell you what, final segment. Stay there. We're going to come back in six more minutes. I want you to finish the story. I'm Alex Jones with ManCow. Stay with us.
Introducing Pro.
All right, final segment with ManCow.
It hide behind
this. You can follow him on Twitter. We'll put that up on screen for TV viewers here in a moment. But he was getting into Harry Lennox, who's a big actor. We looked it up on record, been friends with Obama for 15 years or so or longer. And he told ManCow, and I mean, ManCow, in your words, folks can follow you at ManCow Mueller on Twitter, and he said this in front of your whole TV crew there at the Fox Studios in Chicago. You also have a TV show there, folks that just tuned in. And, of course, you also are contributing to Fox National. He told you in front of all these people that he's horrible. I basically, you know, lived with him. He shadowed me. I mean, this shows that they hired an actor to literally try to train him up, I guess, for the Senate seat at the state level and then the federal level. And he did just come out of nowhere. This is bombshell news, but I don't expect them to even pick this up because the establishment obviously doesn't want this info out. But recap anything else that Lennox said and finish your point.
Well, look, I don't know where to begin, Alex. He said that Obama shadowed him, that he couldn't shake him. It was kind of like a booger on your finger, is kind of the feeling I got, that he couldn't shake him and that there's nothing there. And that's the point I wanted to make about abused children, that you know, in order to protect themselves, they want to make everybody happy. So as I sat talking to Obama, you know, he was Christian with me. He was Muslim with the next person that came over and talked to him. And he's whatever you want him to be, but there's nothing there. And that's basically what Lennox was saying. There's nothing there. He's an empty vessel. He's whatever you want him to be. And perfect to be manipulated, a perfect puppet. You know, I thought about when Brian Henson was in my studio and Kermit was sitting there and it was just a green glob, but it came to life once his hand was there, you know, once the hand was manipulating. And that's kind of Obama. He's just kind of, there's nothing there. It's dead. Until his backers, his controllers, put what he needs to say on the teleprompter. There's nothing there. I mean, he's very stupid. I talked with him, Alex. You know that. I spent time with him before he was anybody. I knew more about the church, that abomination of a church, before I knew about Obama. But Lennox is a brilliant actor. And if you watch him, that's what Obama's supposed to act like. The take charge leader.
And it's weird because when you watch Lennox, I thought he was copying Obama and Superman and in TV shows and stuff. And I guess that's why Lennox is irritated, because he trained Obama and now he sees him up there destroying the country, playing the part of Harry Lennox. Yeah. This is huge. ManCow, thank you so much for the time and your courage.
Hey, Alex.
Yes, sir.
I want to say this. I really believe that Lennox is one of the finest people I've ever met. I think that he probably wasn't aware of how this would go with Obama. He did know back in 98 that you know, that Obama was telling him he was going to be president. I don't think Harry believed that. And I do think that Harry Lennox loves his country. So I really do believe that.
Yeah, and I think for Harry's own safety, it's good this is out now. Contact Lennox. Hey, help us get him on, ManCow. We'll have him on with you. So I think we should flesh this out now. This is a big deal. Thank you very much, ManCow.
See ya.
All right, there goes Eric ManCow Mueller, top show on History Channel. He's got two more TV shows coming out. And syndicated radio host. He's a pretty credible guy telling you all that intel. Briefly, ladies and gentlemen, we're only running this for a couple more weeks because we're going to end up selling out of them. This happens. We do this every fall, but they're selling out so quick. 20% off on all the ProPure gravity-fed, highest quality stainless steel filters that cuts out the fluoride, the glyphosates, all of it. Promo code WATER20 at InfoWarsStore.com. And it is your purchases that support this broadcast. We bring you the very best products, the lowest prices. Promo code WATER20 at InfoWarsStore.com or when you call 888-253-3139. And we got more of the amazing proprietary nascent pure iodine in. It's available now and now shipping at InfoWarsLife.com for your thyroid protection. All right, here's the deal. I'm going to crystallize for you. In fact, guys, I meant to ask you in the break. Will you print me a transcript of that abomination that Obama just put out, his whole 30-minute regurgitation of old lies? Because for the nightly news tonight, but also on the radio show today, we have all the clips of him saying, you can keep your plan under this legislation, Obamacare, period. And then he said, I never said that. And then he said, okay, I did say it, I'm sorry. And the today is like, well, it's not working as well as it should, but it's working pretty darn great. But by the way, I'm going to let you have your old plans now. This is exactly what they did with the whole banker bailout bill in 2008 and the subsequent bank regulations and all the housing market changes where, okay, we'll let you keep your house now if you sign this new agreement, which even waived more of your rights. And then they take your house. Like, we're going to let you, as soon as Obama got in 2009, I'm going to let you keep that house now. And then you just pay 6 months more, and then they screw you out of that money. They just came in with a deal to let you get deeper into the mortgage. And that's exactly what this was. I was just watching CNN, and they were saying, Obama's going to get a big boost out of this, turning defeat into victory, snatching victory from the jaws of defeat. This is a great plan. You're going to let you keep your plan. He's going to fix it. And all they're doing is stalling it. And, of course, Larry Summers said this yesterday. The architect of the derivative scam, the chief scam artist living. If you want to say somebody's captaining this ship of scam, it's him. Here's Summers.
But if you look at the medium run and the long run, the important thing that's happened for growth is that in the last 3 years since Obamacare was passed, we have bent the curve on health care costs. For the first time since the Second World War, health care as a share of GDP has stopped going up. And that offers huge promise with respect to the future of the federal deficit, which looks much more much less serious than it did even a couple of years ago. It means much less burdens on businesses, which means more competitive American producers. It means the ability to pass on higher wages to American workers. So let's keep some perspective here. We have had an outcome with respect to health care costs that is well beyond what anything
the average healthcare cost has doubled, and that's on record. You lying piece of trash. I mean, but you got to understand, people watch CNN and MSNBC when that snaggletoothed lizard gets up there, and he could literally sit there in the backyard with Labrador Retriever droppings and put it in white bread and tell people it was a chocolate sandwich. And I'm telling you, his supporters would shove it in their mouth and eat it. I mean, I hate to talk like that, but these people literally are telling us to eat. You know what? Oh, I just can't handle it anymore. This job, man, I need a vacation. I tell you, the fact that I have to focus on these scumbags all day, I got to do it, though. We've got to stop them. I know people are in denial. It's like you're sick of looking at these people, and I get it. It's funner to go learn about male soap operas like football and, you know, have all your guys you got crushes on and everything. In a giant latent homosexual country. But, you know, the whole issue here, nothing against that, guys. You like it, I understand. Watch the quarterback get down there by the center and everything and rub on his rumpus and everything. I'm going to stop right there. I'm sorry. Just a little bit of humor. I apologize. I'm going to stop right there. It's gallows humor. It's sarcasm, ladies and gentlemen, to a point. But, you know, all real funny humor has a large kernel of truth at the heart of it. But we're going to go to break, and I'm going to reset and try to get focused. Just looking at Larry Summers and his total BS mobile is something hard for me to deal with. And Obozo, again, is now promising he's going to fix the plan, which I told you. And now all his idiot supporters will just be rope-a-doped again until the country totally implodes. File the big insurance companies, isolate everyone, and strip mine everyone, as Dylan Radigan said.
My friends, Alex Jones here to tell you
about... Folks, we're into hour number two. Thank you for joining us. We're going to have wide open phones in this hour. We have a special guest, heavily wounded combat veteran, who's an amazing artist and a pro-Second Amendment activist. He's going to be joining us coming up in studio. And he is another remarkable example of human resilience, because I would describe his wounds as Darth Vader level. Mario Lopez is going to be in studio, paintingsbymariolopez.com. And he is an established artist in his own right. And he's going to be coming on and also talk about his journey, a religious journey, and how he's made it through his adversities. And he'll obviously give us some combat perspectives as a veteran of Iraq and Afghanistan in a lot of heavy combat. So that's coming up at the start of the next hour. And so we're going to talk about a host of issues with him coming up. But we're going to have open phones right now and cover the news. What's your response to the front man in chief, the fraudster in chief up there for 30 minutes, saying, okay, now they're going to let you keep your existing plan that 10 plus million people have been kicked off of. McClatchy says it'll be 52 million that are kicked off total. And then there's no move to do that. They're just going to call it your existing plan, but then increase the plan. So this is the scam of scams going on. And meanwhile, the bigger scam is that they're kicking off more than 40 million people are being cut to part-time wages because Obamacare was written by big business to lower wages of the average American. That's why they're going to raise the minimum wage again, but you're going to only get half as much work, and then they're going to tell you supplementally, go on welfare. So that is the basic plan on that front. And if you go over the transcript of his speech, I know I've watched clips of it, it's basically reissuing the same lie now. He's already gone through, you can keep your plan under this bill, period. Then he said, I never said that. Then he said, okay, I'm sorry that the plan isn't perfect, but it's working pretty good. Now he said that again, but said, now we're going to work on letting you keep your old plan. But you've already been kicked off of it, and they're just going to kick you off, and you're going to say, that's not true. And see, how do I know this? Well, I've watched it so many times in other countries and here. 2009, they had these assistance acts passed and stimulus acts and a bunch of other stuff passed to have homeowners not kicked out of their houses. But all it would do was basically increase your mortgage, and then if you ever missed one payment, you waive all your rights and instantly lose your house. So it let the banks get a little more money out of you and then take the house cleaner later and waive your rights because they had you in fraudulent mortgages and it sold them. So, I got a deal for you. You're going to be able to keep your house. The deal is I waive my rights and you're allowed to screw me. And then I lose my house. But by the millions, people toddled in and signed the agreements and then lost their houses anyways and more money. It's the art of betrayal. This is how con artists operate. This is how I've been saying this for several months, how the Nigerian emails work. They get 5,000 promising 15 million. Then, oh my gosh, Prince Abubi needs another 10,000, and then he will call you and you will get the 15 million. We're sorry, Prince Abubi has been detained and arrested. He needs 20,000 to get out of jail and he will give you 50 million. Then you never hear from Prince Abubi again. Now, Ted Cruz and Ann Coulter have now picked up my exact analogy, which is great. That's what everybody does. All of them, Glenn Beck, you name it. I like that. That's the real power of this show, is not even the 15 million we reach a week or the millions a day with Infowars.com. It is that we speak common sense, and now we're actually creating a common sense talking point for folks to understand. So the toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231. First-time callers, your take on Obama's speech. Do you believe him this time? If you do, I've got some oceanfront property in Arizona, and from my front porch, you can see the sea. And, of course, if you'll buy that, I'll throw the Golden Gate in free. And if you buy that, I wrote that song, not George Strait. I'm being sarcastic. George Strait, at least knows sing it. The point is, I think it was in, like, high school when that song came out. That's a joke, folks. I'm not saying I wrote that. I'm acting like, the absurdity of I've got some oceanfront property in Arizona, and from my front porch you can see the sea. And if you'll buy that, I'll throw the Golden Gate in free. Because I don't love you, now if you'll buy that. This is the entire art of betrayal over and over and over again. As everybody's isolated, that's why they don't want families. They don't want men and women together. Listen, women are just as smart as men are smarter. They have triple the connections between left and right hemisphere. Hitler said, first you get the women, then you've got the children, so follow the men. 83%, last time I checked, of purchases are decided on by women. And so most of the propaganda targets women, and women on average are more emotional. And so the whole system says, women, you're in charge now. Your man's the problem. You get him in line, we'll run society safe. That's what house slaves were in Rome and then in other civilizations were the women. Because you could, they found slave masters going back thousands of years in Babylon, Egypt, you name it, and then Rome. Women made better administrators under a government over men. And that's what all this is. You get women in, you say, we're doing this to be reasonable, we're doing this to be friendly, and they will try to be compliant and try to work within the system. And that works great in a village of 100 people. The men all come in, you know, from battle or whatever, bleeding. The women take care of them, cook, feed them, send them back out as machines to go get the food and go kill the enemy for us. But in a modern system, we come back and we're with a programmed creature. Programmed with all these false ideas where the man's always weak, the man's always bad, the man gets home, he's working two jobs, you're working one job, but still he needs to clean, Gloria Steinem said. The kids don't even need to clean, he needs to clean. And if you make him dinner, that's a lowly thing. That way your family's broke up, the state's your man, he's your pimp, and then you create kids that'll be warriors and workers for the state. You're now a drone. The woman's a drone, the man's a drone. That's modern feminism, which they sell as, it's for the women, cigarettes. Oh, I better smoke those. It's for the women, don't ever have kids. It's for the women. And they sell the idea, and then look how disempowered women are, making less money than ever, total objects, the society degenerating around us so that we're all isolated. And now, and of course, the men are taught, go look at guys 4 hours a day while your wife's upstairs. Go look at other men all day in spandex grabbing each other. With other men all day, imagining, looking at so-called warriors in simulated combat and then bragging to each other the strategy and how male you are because you figured out all the moves and all the plays and you know what the coach is going to do. You're supposed to be combat measuring the government. You're supposed to be affecting the future battlescape. You're supposed to be in combat in business. You're supposed to be in combat raising your sons and daughters to be strong and honorable and not trusting corrupt people and learning how to only work with those that are honorable and good. You're supposed to be building a family name, building a family empire, aggressively defending each other, aggressively having fealty towards one another as a combat unit. That this planet has been total war, total death against big cats, big bears, lions, tigers, cobras, rattlesnakes, the elements, starvation, other tribes attacking. And your tribe didn't get it together as a cohesive group, you were gone. And they've come in and just ruined everybody so that we're all just easy to roll over to the point of now, they've taken the most aggressive, freedom-oriented, wildcatting, freebooting country the world's ever seen and turned us into the most dumbed-down, slovenly, lazy, welfare junkie fools, with those of us still working, holding the whole thing up, with total warfare, black against white, Hispanic against white, old against young, man against woman, children with all the cartoons taught to be bad, rebel against their parents, don't discipline your kids so they're out of control. This is what the Bible talked about at every civilization that was collapsing. It talked about that. And we know, first you get the women, then you've got the children, so follow the men. The words of Adolf Alois Hitler, look them up. And Joseph Goebbels also paraphrased that. It was the women in Nazi Germany that demanded, in a kind of mutated Spartan idea, come home with your shields or on them. And again, that's normal for the woman to be demanding, go out there and kill the enemy, go out there and bring me a bunch of meat, go out there, I'm with these kids in the cave, okay, defending when you're away. Well, women aren't wimps under this empowered natural human system. They're empowered. And see, now we're isolated, we're broken, the globalist corporate system is rolling in, moving in, taking over. The total destruction of the human family, by design. And now they're going to get rid of the healthcare, they're going to get rid of the jobs, everything is destroy the male role model, because once they've taken down the individual man, there's no one to stand at the village. And the women believe they're having victory against the men with the state. They believe they're having a victory when they have an abortion. They believe they're having a victory because they've imprinted on the state, and then men have imprinted in a arrested development on going and staring at men's rear ends all day watching the NFL. And then fantasizing that that's what men do, and that that's what men are on growth hormone and steroids and run around running into each other on a field all day. So it just totally takes all male instincts for three-dimensional chess and survival. Where to go hunt, where to go, how to prepare, where to travel. That army's too big. We've got to flee. We've got to move as nomads. There's no understanding, none of it. All of our development on this planet, out the door, destroyed for the administrative convenience of the ruling class technocrats, who all live traditional lives, by the way, at the very top. We'll be right back. All right, let's go ahead. George Strait's from right around here, from just north of San Antonio. Got his start pretty much the broken spoke. He won't play Austin anymore, I heard, at least for a while, because they're so smug and trendy. Anyways, let's go ahead and talk to Matt in Canada. Matt, you're on the air. Then Adam, Paul, Dean, and Justin. So what do you think of Lord Gracious Dear Leader Obama saying that he will give you lower health care prices and that Obamacare is a great success? What do you think about that new speech?
Well, I was just thinking about that, not about football and Obama, actually. But if nobody has health care and there's a wave of radiation sickness coming from Fukushima, I was just wondering if you thought there was any kind of correlation between those two things.
You know, the globalists don't care that 91% of the 420-plus reactors are leaking now. They just blow up and leak all the time. It's not even an issue now. They just turn the alarms off when they melt down or have partial meltdowns in the U.S. now. It's just a minor footnote. So they've waved a magic wand and say radiation is good. And unless our leaders are really blood-drinking lizards that like radiation, they're crazy. And, of course, I don't think they're blood-drinking lizards that like radiation, so I just think it shows the nihilistic disconnect. But, yes, Obamacare is meant so you can't get real health care and so you can water down the quality of care and then deny people health care. It's all in the legislation. It's a torpedo to the broad side of the country to lower the wages, make us a part-time nation, force us on welfare, let the insurance companies lower the quality of care, and force 50 million people to buy it and kick everybody off of it and make them double down. So it's a private tax ruled by the Supreme Court to foreign banks that own the insurance companies. I mean, could you think of a better screw job? Well, yes. Now they're moving towards, in North America, taking money out of your account yearly to give it directly to private banks in bail-ins like Cyprus. So if you don't like that, we could throw in guillotines for free. Maybe they'll start chopping our heads off and telling us that it's eternal life. And Obama can have a press conference about that and tell us that down is up and up is down and black is white and left is right and cable or elves are real. How's that sound?
Oh, well, it sounds great. I mean, also with not a lot of Canadians being awake, they don't even know what a bail-in is, let alone that they're planning to do this to us with the...
Well, you're right. Your new budget does announce they're planning to take your bank account money. And, I mean, why not have a yearly deal? I mean, it worked in Cyprus. America puts up with Obamacare, Obamanation care. Why not take Canadians' bank accounts? You don't like that? We'll throw in a SWAT team for free. You don't like it? Matt, I appreciate your terrorist call. I say give everything you got to the government. Terrorist. Let's talk to Justin in Georgia. You're on the air. Go ahead. Go ahead, terrorist.
Yes, I know this is a little bit off topic of the healthcare issue and everything, and probably not that important in the grand scheme of things, but my question was about talk show hosts, and I've noticed there's been a change in Sean Hannity. He's sounding a little bit more like Alex Jones, and I've also listened occasionally to Michael Medved, and you know who he is.
Yeah, he's a movie review guy, has a tiny audience. Yeah, I know who he is.
Yeah. But do you think this guy is... He was so against Ron Paul. He's trashed your show a lot. And he just seems like he might be working for...
Oh, there's no doubt Medved's like a Southern Poverty Law Center type guy. Listen, I was at the RNC in 2004 covering it. Had the passes, you know, all the way down to the floor. And he saw me and began yelling something like, "Are you saying they blew it up? Are you saying that?" And then to police, to like act like I was saying blow something up. "Are you saying the government blew up the towers? Are you saying..." I mean, he's a smart guy, and I kind of jetted out of there. whenever I saw that. And I realized that's a really dangerous guy, Michael Medved. But, I mean, he's not even worth talking about. His audience is so pathetic and tiny.
We're on the mark.
I am going to go right back to your phone calls here in just a moment, and then back in the huge NSA domestic spy grid breaking news. Huge news on the open borders front and a lot more today. The toll-free number to join us on air is 800-259-9231. But first off, there's a lot of reasons that I created InfoWarsLife.com and came out with the first of many products. But you notice we could have already rushed out a lot of products. We haven't done that because, quite frankly, we go to laboratories that are the most established, the most elite, and where products can cost $10, $15 a piece, in some cases $20, stuff we're developing, that I could buy for a dollar and a half from the big factory leading competitors, bottled. Like I could buy vitamin D for a dollar and a half bottled. I'm buying it for $10, the most organic, unbelievable, off-the-chart types. Whatever I'm going to start taking, whatever we've done research on, neurotically, for years, and since launching this the last 2 months, we only have one product out. And that's because that was years of research and months of development and finding the very best. And we've got five or six other products in the chain. One is about to be produced. It took us months to just get this particular ingredient from Tibet. And normal products like this would sell for $100. This product that's coming out is going to sell for $35. Just to give you an idea how much these ingredients are costing us, in many cases, it's half the cost. Most supplements, folks, have four or five times the markup. And I'm not saying that's bad in a free market. The point is that it blows me away that a lot of the people that talk the most about how, you know, they've got such clean, pure, great stuff, it's like literally $2 a bottle, $3 a bottle. Not us, folks. We are neurotically researching. Like, I've got a brand of coffee coming out. I use coffee, obviously, love coffee, found a type of coffee that I enjoyed the best that I've been drinking for 15 years. We had the deal, the contract. They got scared because they're nationally distributed. It comes from Chiapas, which is basically like Guatemala, but even better in South Central Mexico. It's my favorite coffee, Arabica. They backed out. It took me a year to find a connection to the exact same supply that only comes in once a year. That's the type of coffee I'm putting out when it comes out in a couple weeks. Multi-years in the works. And when it's sold, it's sold. That's all we could get. Talk about fair trade. This is directly from the Chiapas rebels. You're like, well, they're like commies. Why would you do that? They're not even really commies, folks. It's just the only thing they know. They're fighting the corrupt Mexican government, whatever. The point is they're actually free market. The point is that that's the type of stuff I bring you. I'm like, what is this coffee? Like 15 years ago, my wife was drinking it. She's my girlfriend. Started drinking that coffee, tried everything. It's the best. From my view, we'll see if you like this coffee like I do. It's not out yet. The point is Survival Shield Atomic Nascent Iodine. I mean, I was told by all the medical doctors, scientists, nutritionists, you need iodine. The best is nascent. And I did research. Most of the other brands are not really nascent, just iodine stuck in alcohol. There's some real nascent in alcohol, but it tends to break down. We have it in the organic glycerin base that literally nobody else has. And it is done with a proprietary system of sound waves and electricity that is just unbelievable. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to just show you one thing. It's not just protect the thyroid, increase radiation levels, all the rest of the stuff. Look at this Harvard study. I want to show folks on document cam with our TV viewers. Harvard study confirms fluoride reduces children's IQ. And then it goes into its compounded lesions on the brain if you don't have iodine. Now, even the garbage iodine the government put in the salt back in the 20s and 30s and 40s increased. And here's a Business Insider article. IQs 15 points, a major study shows. That's Business Insider. But now they've removed it in the last 30 years and put halogens in the water, like hydrofluorosilicic acid, fluoride, other forms of fluoride, all the rest of the garbage. That's the biggest reason people are zombies from my research. So what do? We bring something to fund our media operation that I believe in, that I've done the research on, that I use, that I've had dramatic brain effects with. I mean, there's no doubt this is not placebo. Plus, the studies show it. The only problem is I'm so crazed already that it's hard being this sober and this awake. It's like being on a drug. Just being awake and alive. If I take a vacation, it's like I'm on a drug after getting a break. You know what I mean? It's like people take drugs to dumb themselves down. I know why. It's hard to be this conscious. The point is, we've got a bunch of it in now. It probably won't sell out for a few weeks. We're trying to get more right now, but it's so proprietary. They've got one calibrated machine that can make it in the country. It's Survival Shield Nascent Iodine from InfoWarsLife.com. We have it right now. You can order it. We've caught up now on shipping. You can order it. It ships out in a matter of days. InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And we've got two different types of Arabica Mexican coffee, high mountain shade-grown coffee coming out. One's got the mushrooms infused in it for immune support. We've got the other. And it's not going to be here for a few weeks. It's been hand-roasted in Colorado. It's on its way, I think, Friday in the truck to Austin, Texas. So you're supporting the people of Mexico with real jobs, not being at the slave factories in Mexico City or up here, and you're getting high quality roasted in America. You cannot beat it. And again, it's not being sold yet. Just letting you know that's coming. I'll give you an example. 2 years working on this coffee. Could have bagged anything. Could have sold anything. 2 years. We will sell no wine until it's time. I guarantee if I sold wine, it's not going to be crud. And that's what I'm trying to tell you. But it'll also be a value. Maybe we should come out with wine. Jesus did. The point is, of course, I can't do it like he did. Like, you know. But the point is, excuse me. The point is, that's what Michael Jackson called the wine, folks. I'm being sarcastic. The point is, Survival Shield, Nascent Iodine, one-of-a-kind proprietary, InfoWarsLife.com. And I'm sorry, a lot of the competition is really mad and upset. Hey, any type of iodine is better than nothing, folks. Iodine and salt, the gourmet salts, Himalayan salt. If you can't afford this, get that. It's better than the birth defects, all the stuff, the retardation it's connected to. Just look it up. Just get your iodine. I mean, the government's own studies admit that. I believe from my research, we have the best, and it supports the broadcast, InfoWarsLife.com. Or 888-253-3139. And we have 20% off on the Pro Pure, Pro One. Cut out the fluoride, the glyphosates, all of it. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com will take you there too. 20% off with promo code WATER20. And we're selling more of these than ever. I always do this in November into December. It usually sells out in like a month and then it's on back order for a few weeks. The way these are selling, we might have to stop this in 2 weeks. So get your order in now. The whole selection discounted. The King, the Nomad, all of it, the Traveler. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And I had it explained to me, our profit is so small on the pitchers that have the filters in it, because they're only like $54. I mean, the filter ought to cost that much that we actually don't make money on that, but I don't care. I mean, just so free market and so aggressive about absolutely, you know, just absolutely giving the lowest price. I'm told I think we make $2 on the pitcher. So anyways, just annihilating the competition. We've got dash cam systems in, lower than all the competition. Look it up for yourself, with a free 8 gig memory stick. The leading competitor is about $130 without the stick, just to give you an idea. That's the type of super aggressive stuff we're engaged in here. Okay, so InfoWarsStore.com. Okay, that's a long plug, mid-air refueling. That's how we fund the whole media operation. I don't get paid by the radio network, ladies and gentlemen. I get paid what I originally under contract got paid from Genesis in 1997. I get paid $2,000 a month. Never changed the deal. And because I have an advertising deal to have half the advertising. And so that's what I get paid. So technically I do get paid, but I fund an operation that costs $8 million a year now to run, $8 million a year, that has the effect of operations that have billions, thanks to the grace of God, with your support, selling high-quality products. And so that's the bottom line. So there's my plug for the day. Please support our local AM and FM affiliates. If you're a local business, it is your duty to support the local sponsors, or to be a sponsor of the show if you believe in the First Amendment, which is under attack. You see the IRS persecuting the Tea Party, gun owners, veterans groups, pro-life groups. That's because we can beat them. They're trying to shut us up. Support alternative media. Spread the word about it. Spread the word about our local stations. Like 1530 in Chicago. Stations like that. That is so essential, ladies and gentlemen. We have a chance to turn this around. Okay, let's go to your calls. Go to them right now. Let's go to Adam in North Carolina. You're on the air, sir. Thanks for holding.
Hey, Alex. This is the first time call for me by the show and what you do. My first question before I just give you my take on Obamacare was my next-door neighbor. He is actually a truck driver, and he told me he's also a gun owner, and he had mentioned something to me about two types of bullets coming out, which one was aluminum, and they could go through everything, and then these plastic bullets that have microchips in them that they could track when you fired it, where you fired it, where, you know, and it's like has all this information. So if someone stole it from you, you know, if you had this, you can get blamed for something you didn't even do. Have you ever heard of that?
Yes. They call them safety slugs. The air marshals use them because it won't shoot through the aircraft. But into somebody's body, it absolutely, like I've seen demonstrations and done it myself. You should shoot wet phone books that simulate human flesh. They've been soaked for a day in water. And a normal bullet won't even shoot through it, say for a 357 Magnum. But you shoot these, would say, I think the name Sure safety slugs. You shoot it with a Sure safety slug, it just balloons it out and just puts all its energy in the first few inches and just splatters everything. And they've got a lot of different versions. They've got sabos or sabos, depending on how you want to pronounce it, that can have a different types of composite cores. Don't have to be metal. Don't have to be steel or lead. And then you've got a plastic jacket that accelerates it down the barrel of the gun.
Chips in or RFID chips?
I don't know anything about putting chips in guns to track people, but they do chip a lot of weapon systems to track them. And they do put a lot of secret chips on weapon systems internally so they can track them by satellite, RFID.
Okay, my take on the Obamacare thing, I mean, fortunately, I don't have to have that right now. I got another year left on my alternative medical care, which is basically the lesser of two evils, but I'm hoping that this whole thing implodes with it because even though I try to warn people that I know, like, wait, don't go on to this thing because it's not meant to work. They're like, oh, well, you know, I'm just going to take my chances. And, you know, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But they don't understand when you're wrong with something like this, it's going to cost you.
Exactly. I mean, yeah. Listen, this is how it works. Obamacare in 60 seconds. They put the myth out. It's free. You go here. You sign up. You go there. All it does is grab your data, give it to the CIA and NSA. That's now mainstream news. And then it's conduited off, and then you get into a process now, standing in line going, well, I've already been here so long, what do I do? Well, you vote for us again, and you'll get your free health care someday. And then meanwhile, you just get your tax refund confiscated. Go ahead.
Yeah, and well, that's why I'm not too anxious to get on that myself. And it's like I'm just thinking that why would anybody be stupid enough to actually take this when you clearly see even the mainstream media is starting to cover this now that they're saying, don't go on it. It's fake. You know, I mean, all the problems that they're having. I mean, with this supposed to be such a high-tech world that we're supposed to have all of this technology, they try to get us to believe that, oh, it's a computer glitch that's causing all this problem. I mean, let's wake up.
No, they have to make it about the site being broken because the bill never gave anybody free health care. It doubled, tripled, and quadrupled and beyond. So, again, it's a and we knew this would happen. We know how their scams run. God bless you. Great points. Let's talk to Dean in California. I hope you're not an extremist racist. You better support Obamacare or you're a racist. Go ahead, racist.
Oh, I'm a trendy, and I just support it so much.
That's more like it. Talk like that. Go ahead.
I just can't believe you just don't accept Obamacare as just your savior, too.
You know, Obama cares about me. That's why he wants me to take shots and wants 11-year-olds to have abortions without mommy knowing. I think that's reasonable. I like MSNBC saying our children belong to the state. I like seven of the czars supporting Mao Zedong, who killed 85 million people. I think all the new Head Start programs teaching kids that the state is God and 2 + 2 = 5. I think that's normal. I think everything's fine.
Oh, that's awesome. I think that's perfect, too. Hollywood's all in on it, and I'm behind them all. 100%.
I love all the anti-family messages on television. I think it's for my own good. They put the fluoride in the water because they care about me.
Oh, yeah. I just, you know, Alex, I tell everybody about you. I even have your, I have a little sticker on my name badge that says Infowars.com. So people can ask me about, you know, what's that? I'm like, that's where I get all my information, folks. I drink Beyond Tangy Tangerine, share that with everybody. I have Survival Shield iodine, just been on that for the last 3 weeks. It's awesome. I have a ProPure water filter, love it. I'm a subscriber. I just think that we're just being undermined. We've been undermined since at least Woodrow Wilson, the dolt, signed us into this whole system.
And then he signed a letter admitting it was a globalist takeover, and then they poisoned him.
Yeah, you know.
At least, you know, I admire Woodrow Wilson. He was an academic they conned. He believed in globalism for freedom. He found out it was a bad deal, and he wrote a letter saying he was going to go public, and they poisoned him that night on the train. Edward Mandel House was involved. Unbelievable.
Oh, that guy. Edward Mandel House. That Rothschild operative was the beginning of the undoing of everything that we loved in our country, and they pulled it over.
Oh, my gosh, this is scary. You know history. Oh, that's scary. Oh. A lot of people say that they think you're showing off when you give them history. No, you're trying to inform them. But the average trendy, though, they just want to just blissfully hop around with a big handlebar mustache and socks that don't match and tattoos all over them. And again, I'm not against handlebar mustaches, tattoos all over them. But you'll see like some supermodel with some loser who doesn't even have a job because she thinks she's going to win because the TV said this is what's cool. And of course, she leaves him in a month and goes for another trendy. She thinks someday if I get the right trendy, I'll be successful. And then they're like all scared. You know, women are like scared of like men that actually own companies and run things. But that's how screwed up this society is. Anyways, go ahead.
Like it's just like these new shows out nowadays, like the one with all the scientists on it that everybody watches. I can't remember. The Big Bang Theory. I always say that if they ever wrote a real man into that show, he'd steal every one of the girls on there.
Well, I mean, number one, listen, you can see people, trendies, literally trying to live out television. Like, it's real. Like, because, again, like dogs. Humans are very similar to dogs. We are social creatures. We learn off social stuff. But in a real pack, you would emulate the real alpha that knows how to win. But they create false alphas on television, and then the males and the females all follow it and then wonder why they're such losers. It's designed as a virus, a psychological warfare virus, to make you malfunction.
Along with the vaccines, you know, and all that forced crap that's going to be forced on us, going to just help implode us even that much faster.
Absolutely. Listen, folks, if you want to be successful, seethe with power. That's what you do. Run around in the woods at night with your tongue hanging out. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen. I did that last night. I remember about 14 years ago seeing a Pentagon paper that was on the MIT website where they were going to have drones that fly around and face scan you and then kill you if you're on the kill list in America. But they also have them with tear gas and knockout gas. This is CBS Pittsburgh. CMU facial recognition technology could be future of catching criminals. How about we send these drones to the White House? And it goes on to say it's mounted in drones to fly around the city. Yeah, and they're in Pittsburgh. They actually, we won a lawsuit against them for one of our reporters. Stuart Rhodes was our lawyer. He's a constitutional lawyer. They arrested dude with the mainstream media. They go, oh, you're not mainstream, but you're up on the hill videotaping us beat people? We're going to arrest you. And they took him to a torture center where they strapped everyone out in the rain for about 8 hours and then screamed and yelled at him and did other things I won't mention on air because people don't want these humiliating things heard on air. Oh, yeah, sometimes you get abused and didn't happen to do it. It happened to others we know. You don't want it talked about. That's America. So you need to understand what really goes on. They had the army in there, a bunch of guys that probably run places like Abu Ghraib. They had them at an army base. That's what goes on in America. They train 24/7 to take us on while naming the veterans as the new terrorist. By the way, here it is. Obama claims enforcement discretion in his latest speech, if you can call it that, the latest spillage of lies, to make Obamacare changes. That's the Washington Times. And then the Weekly Standard has Howard Dean saying, quote, I wonder if Obama has the legal authority to do this. No, he doesn't, but it's all a giant scam. They'll let a few people have their plan with the insurance company. It's the lottery ticket phenomenon. So folks believe that, oh, you can get your old plan back. You understand how that works? Okay, good. Remember, we told you what would happen before it happened. I'm trying to explain, people, we're not winging this. We know exactly the enemy attack profile, okay? It's very, very simple what's going on. It'd be like if a bunch of wasps were swarming around your front door, and we said, hey, you might not want to go under those. You want to kill those. They might sting you. And my mother was actually hornets once. I'd already moved out. I was like 19. I went over to their house. There were these big green yellow hornets right above the door, and I, in a hole above the door. They'd gotten into the bricks, and I said, Mom, you got to kill those. They're going to sting you. Hornets are really mean when you're slamming the door. Those things just chased me the other day when I came over here to visit. She said, I don't like to kill things, Alex. They're mine, and you're not going to kill them. This is an exact quote. My dad has a beehive he won't let me kill. And I like bees, man. This is another house they have now. And these stinking bees are out by their hot tub. I won't even bring my kids over there half the time when those bees, because they're aggressive. They even had a bee scientist out from UT when I was demanding they be killed a few years ago. And he's like, well, these are actually an ancient Middle Eastern variety that someone brought over here and very rare. They are aggressive, but not Africanized. You can't kill them, and we'll remove them if you want. And my parents are out of town. I want to go over there and kill those things right now. They just stung me a few months ago, twice in one day. Rob Dew got stung by them. He came over after we took the kids whitewater rafting. We went over there to get in the hot tub. Stinking bees attacked him. Anyways, my mother got stung right between the eyes by the hornet and couldn't see for a couple days when her eyes swelled shut. Needless to say, my dad went and got that wasp spray that shoots 12 feet, and they were dead. He went to the store that day. They went, of course, they don't sting my dad and my mother. It's like the bees know who they are. And you know what? I told him when he left town, they're out of town, I think I'm going to go over there today. Run over to the hive with like a can of flea bomb or something. Hit the button and cram it in the hole. I don't like killing bugs either, man. But I have been attacked by these things for 15 years they've lived in that house. I've probably been stung 8-9 times. Rob Dew was attacked. They were in his hair. Like in a cartoon, they chased him. And they live on 4 acres in the middle of town. It's a great place. But, I mean, you know, there's also a lamppost with a microphone in it. The government just put it. I need to go over there. Well, there's a lot of work to do at my parents' house while they're out of town. Well, there's the pro-gun sheriff we've had on the broadcast before. Forget his name. We're pulling it up right now. Jakari's interviewed him. I've interviewed him. Children's Hospital on lockdown after reports of shooting. Let's hear what he has to say. Let's fade that up real quick and then go back to calls. And then we will come back in studio with our guest.
Police officers were here conducting a warrant.
David Clark's his name.
Guy who they got information. The guy was wanted on a warrant, felon in possession of a firearm, that he was here at the hospital. They proceeded to the neonatal progressive care unit on the 7th floor of Children's Hospital. It's where children who are sick and infants that need extreme care are taken care of. The officers identified the individual who was holding his baby, or holding a baby at the time. They informed him after identifying he was under arrest. He put the baby down and appeared to want to cooperate in being taken into custody. He then fled down the hallway, and while fleeing, produced a handgun, and the officers were in pursuit. He turned around several times with that handgun in his hand, and the officers fired several shots, striking the suspect. The suspect is being treated at Frater right now as we speak.
Okay, good. Nobody hurt but the suspect. All right, good. There you go. That's enough of that.
Mother.
Notice they can just immediately come out and tell you what's going on instead of hiding everything that's going on for 10 days. Like if it was a staged event. Let's go to your phone calls. Let's talk to Paul. Paul in Florida. You're on the air. Welcome.
Hey, Alex. How are you today?
I'm doing all right, brother. What's on your mind today?
Great show. Really wanted to commend you for being the canary in the coal mine, as Mad Cow put it today. Are you feeling better or exonerated knowing that everything you said has come to fruition?
No, not really, because I wish I would have been proven wrong. And now it's even worse than I thought it could be, quite frankly. And it just gets more crazy by the minute. But I do feel good that people are finally understanding we're in trouble. And so people need to realize, though, it's not just up to an Alex Jones or, you know, whoever else is out there. It's up to all of us to resist tyranny wherever we see it. But thank you for your kind words, brother. But I'm just trying to survive here, so please don't commend me.
I wanted to ask you another question if you had the time. What do you think is going to come down this hole? What do you think is going to happen maybe before 2016? What do we have to look forward to?
Well, that depends on what we do to stop this. We either totally discredit the system and stop complying with everything we can and just point out that it's an alien criminal globalist operation, or they're going to be able to carry out their plans to shut off the economy, to enslave us and collapse us under government and corporate control. So we're under attack. It is a war. Words cannot describe how big a war it is. It's a silent, sneaking, cold war against freedom. And it uses all our institutions against us. The institutions themselves aren't even bad. They're just commandeered. Like an army tank by itself is not bad. It can be used by good people or bad people. Our government has been seized and then grown into a giant behemoth. And we deserve it, though. Not my listeners or myself so much, but none of us are perfect. But the culture got very decadent off what our forebears and the greatest generation, you know, and folks built for us. And they were a great generation. I don't think they were as great as the 1776ers and some of the other folks, but, you know, they came back and demanded civil rights. Mainly veterans, white combat veterans came back particularly and said, we're not going to be part of this. There were sagebrush rebellions all over the country, and people said, we're going to have freedom. And Kennedy said, we're going to have freedom, and they blew his head off. So that's what it comes down to, is there's corrupt elements that want to continue all this, but if we don't stop them, they're going to stage false flags and bring in total tyranny. We have a very interesting guest in studio coming up. Combat veteran gives his take on 9/11, the Second Amendment, and so much more. Ladies and gentlemen, out, out, brief candle is what William Shakespeare wrote. That's what life is like. It goes by like dusk till dawn. But what matters is doing the right thing while you're alive on this planet and building a better world for future generations. That is not even service. That is fulfillment. And it is in service to humanity. And no service is perfect. No cause is perfect. But in the final equation, it's having a heart that tries to do the right thing, that stands for justice, is what in the final equation will be judged by the creator of the universe. And your calls will come up at the bottom of the hour for those that are holding. I've got some other news on the NSA surveillance grid, you name it. Our guest will be riding shotgun with us throughout the hour. We're going to talk about his story exclusively until the bottom of the hour, but then he'll be with us for the rest of the hour and hopefully do an interview for expanded coverage on the InfoWars Nightly News coming up at 7 o'clock Central tonight. But I, a few weeks ago, 2.5 weeks ago, was down in San Antonio for the open carry rally, which under state law, you can have rifles openly anywhere in public spaces in Texas. But the police chief said, I'll arrest you if you do that. So this is the real cutting edge of the civil rights, human rights, God-given rights movement. And so we went down there. Over 1,000 people showed up with the Open Carry Texas and other groups. And I gave a speech with an M4 strapped on my back. And we weren't sure even when we went there whether they were going to arrest us or not, but they backed off. The next day, they started arresting people that legally had guns, but now lawsuits have already been filed. So that's what all of this is really about. And it was the first rally since the Alamo happened in 1836, because it was a warehouse until the 50s when they made it a historical site. And then there's never been a rally allowed there, and it's fitting it was a Second Amendment rally, because the Alamo was about people coming to take the guns. That's what started the Texas Revolution, just like the revolution against King George III started when he came to take the guns. Hollywood tries to make it a racial issue or all this other stuff. No, it was about guns. That was the heart of it, period. Ed Gonzalez, they came to take the guns. That's how it all started, period. That's the main, that's like 80% of it. And I studied the history big time and had family involved on both sides of my family, my mother and father's sides, involved in that historical situation. So I'm there and I talked to hundreds of people while I was there. But I was really touched by speaking with and hearing the things that Army veteran Mario Lopez had to say to me. And he was a combat Army combat engineering unit in Iraq and then Afghanistan. And his second tour was in a IED explosion. And then he gave me his card, and I went and looked at his paintings online. And wow, really an amazing artist. And the work he's done is very touching and very poignant and also very archetypal and powerful at the same time, especially the combat art, the art that gets into what soldiers go through, soldiers that are wounded, soldiers that are missing a piece of the puzzle as he basically paints it. And then I talked about it, and I said, hey, did you sell out? And I talked about it. He said, well, I'll sell out all the time anyways because it's such good art. And I think it's really a testament to all that he's gone through. So many people, my dad, you know, would complain about stuff when he was a kid because they were upper middle class, but they would send him to work on local farmers' fields. They would send him to go help carpenters when he was 10 years old so he wouldn't be lazy. And he'd complain about it, and he'd say, hey, I complained I had no shoes till I saw a man who had no feet. And that's really what it's all about, is that I see people that have gone through adversity and gone through great trials and tribulations many times that it turns out have even discovered more of their humanity and are more thankful about life now that they've lost so much. And I think it really is a decadent, slob-like entitlement in this country that is allowing this nation to collapse. And so Army veteran Mario Lopez joins us here in studio. His website is paintingsbymariolopez.com. He also has his Christian ministry website, howiknow.org. And I want to invite him back at least once a year on the show to see what he's doing with his art. And it's good to have him here with us. We can click on that image of him before his injuries, and then we'll talk to him here in studio. If you're a radio listener, you can go to infowars.com/show and actually see the interview here with us right now. But Mario, it's so great to have you in studio, and thank you for traveling up here from San Antonio with your lovely wife.
Yes, sir. Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Thank you. You've got the floor. You said you wanted to talk about your experience in Afghanistan and Iraq first, then get into your art, and then talk about your ministry and obviously, you know, what you've been through, how it's changed you mentally, not just physically.
Yeah, Iraq was a good experience. You know, actually in Iraq, I learned about some of the things that the inconsistencies as far as 9/11 goes and whatnot, and so it helped me to open my mind a little bit, and came home for a year and a half. Went to Afghanistan, and we were scheduled to be there for 18 months, but I was just there for 4 months, and got hit with an IED, got pinned underneath, got burned, and had a lot of miracles during that time. After my injury, I just set God aside and said, I said, you know what, like these doctors and psychologists, and they'll fix me. So put God aside, and didn't work out too well for me. I had experienced some stuff in the supernatural, and then was told it was just PTSD. It was just it's a normal thing that soldiers go through, and not to worry about it. So I went about my life living the way I thought I saw fit. And then about a year and a half after that experience, I got 108 fever, and 105 fever, you can die or have brain damage. I had 108, and I crossed over again to the other side, and then had an angel help me. And then after that, I woke up and I said, all right, Mom, my mom's a minister in San Diego, Texas. I told, all right, Mom, you're right. Everything you've been telling my whole life is true. So I started doing research of creation science. I just did a lot of research. And then later on, I met my wife, which was an ex-biology high school teacher, and she went to Stanford University, and we met, and we just debate for 3 months straight, and then I finally won the debate, you know, and
we're going to talk about that, but I want to get back into your experience because I've talked to so many people, and I've had my own personal experiences. I'm not going to talk about those because the media would make a big issue out of it.
Yeah,
but there is, we see such a small spectrum of the universe. Science has proven that.
Right.
There's all these dimensions, all this other dark matter, you name it. But in every culture, people that don't even believe in angels and God, atheists, you name it, for thousands of years, they have the same experience.
Right.
And I've talked to so many people, like Colonel Craig Roberts and others who died for 10 minutes, totally dead for five, mm-hmm. you know, just brain dead, and literally went up the angel, his guardian angel's whole life, the portal, you're being sent back, doctors couldn't believe it. He's alive like 16, 17 years later after that cancer, it's about 20 years, and he was a Marine, then Army, and then police officer, SWAT team commander, helicopter pilot, survived all this stuff. But so many other people, they talk about that experience. And for folks that have never had these experiences, I feel sorry for them. You know, they say that people that have died before or gotten very close, that's actually almost a gift because you get a lot of enlightenment when that's happened.
Yeah, there's no atheist in a foxhole. No.
Well, tell us about, just people that don't know the face of real war, tell us about the IED. We're going to skip this network break.
The IED, it was a 300-pound IED, so I'm told, by the CID unit that went out and EOD that went out and checked it out. It was a 300-pound IED. They hardline wired it, and they buried the wire in sand, and we just rolled right over it. And when I got hit, I just saw gray everywhere. I knocked out for a couple seconds, and then I woke up, and I saw and smelled the flames. And I just looked up and I was like, all right, Lord, I'm coming to meet you, you know? And, I had 9 203 rounds strapped to my chest, and, 203 rounds for people that don't know what that is. It's like a golf ball sized shotgun shell, but it has a grenade on the end of it instead of a slug. And I had 9 of them. They didn't go off, and my weapon was completely destroyed, non-functioning, you know, as you can tell, I was burned pretty bad. And so that was one of my first miracles.
And you lost your arm? And
I lost my arm. They had to pull me out of the flames to save my life.
So they had to cut your arm off to get you out?
Well, they pulled me out, and it was just
mangled
up pretty bad. And I looked down, and I was like, oh, my beautiful arm, you know, because I've
heard those descriptions of the guys have to go back in there while it's burning, too. They a lot of times get burned.
Luckily, the guys that pulled me out didn't really...
Thank God. In fact, the other guys didn't get hurt as bad as you.
No, some of my battle buddies, they have back problems and PTSD and stuff like that. I was the worst one out because I was pinned down.
Wow, I mean, how long were you pinned inside that armored vehicle?
I have no idea because I got knocked out, but I could imagine it was maybe 5 minutes or so that I can remember. You know, it was a while. You know,
in the flame.
In the flames, yeah.
So you literally were in, I mean, like in a barbecue pit for five minutes.
Yes, barbecue pit, heard the cracking of the flames, and you know, it was surreal. A surreal experience.
What's it like for you now when you see like yuppies and trendies that are lazy and stupid and people that don't even care about their kids? They have everything. They got their arms, their eyes, everything, and then they just could care less about anybody but themselves.
I think they need to really wake up and see what's happening out there because it's going to affect them too, and they'll be the ones, you know, in the trenches, you know, they'll be the ones hiding and they'll be like, I can't believe this is happening to us. And then they'll remember people like you and me telling people the realities.
Let's talk about the angel. Talk about that near-death experience. What happened?
Well, I had started bleeding internally after the surgery. And they're going to put a medical device underneath my skin, underneath my back. I started bleeding internally, and they gave me four pints of blood. Each pint, they were hoping the bleeding would stop internally, and it didn't. I just kept bleeding, and the last pint was a bad batch of blood, and so I got a 108 fever, and they had to remove the device, and when they removed the device, when they moved the bad batch of blood, they couldn't use that same needle because it was obviously tainted. So while I started getting 108 fever, I couldn't get another IV. So I was just out there on my own, no IV. You know, they had to put me in ice packs and stuff. And then about that time, I started crossing over to the other side. And I saw a couple of demons. One was a demon of lust. She looked like Angelina Jolie. You know, she was really gorgeous, but she had green skin. And she was wearing a black sticky garment. And she didn't say I'm the demon of lust or anything, but I could just put two and two together. You know, that's what she was there for. And that sticky garment, I associate that with lust is because it's hard to get away from. You know,
so it was like flypaper trying to get you to choose to go to hell. It was almost a battle right there.
Yeah, it definitely.
Yeah, that happens a lot of people that are right on the edge.
Yeah, there was this other little.
It's like in the Bible when they fought over Moses' body. Go ahead.
There was this classic looking demon. He was actually on my bed and he had a big nose. He was red. He had like maybe 2 feet tall, long fingernails. And he was just scratching at my spirit, trying to separate my body from my soul from my body.
By the way, I never even heard this story.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead.
And he was trying to separate it. And there was this also this, like a rock looking demon. I associate him with like the demon of pride because I had a lot of pride in my life. And he looked like the, Fantastic Four guy, you know, that rock, mm-hmm. That rock guy.
Ben Grimm.
Yeah, he looked like that.
It's clobbering time.
Yeah, but he was like maybe brownish color. And so while I was going through all this, I just was like, oh man, you know, this is happening again, you know, and I was like, man, I didn't learn my lesson. They just started laughing at me, not with their mouth, but in their mind, they started laughing at me like, you didn't learn anything, you know, and you're going with us to hell tonight, you know. Then this angel, as my mom was there praying beside my bed, and I couldn't move, and I just see her there praying, this angel just came out of the ceiling like a whirlwind. And as he was coming down, he struck the biggest guy in the room, that rock demon. And then that's all I remember. But I do remember what he looked like. He looked like, he had blonde hair, blue eyes, and... he was like 10 feet tall. And he looked like the biggest wrestler that I'd ever seen in my whole life. And he had armor on. And his armor was silver, glistening silver with outlined with gold. And he had this sword.
Wow.
And this sword was pretty big. It had holes in it. And I don't know anything about swords or that I like guns. I'm a soldier, you know. And while I was doing research on swords, come to find out that swords and knives and stuff like that with holes is to make them lighter. They're just as strong to make them lighter. And I was like, wow, you know, like stuff I didn't even know that I learned while I was, you know, dying, you know.
Well, sure, you can get knowledge in these type of things that then actually comes true later.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like interdimensional.
Yeah.
Mm. Makes me cry just hearing about it. It's so amazing that the average person doesn't know what's really going on out there.
Yeah, they definitely don't see it in the music industry and even in their schools being taught Darwinism. You know, they just don't see what's really happening and just people just need to really wake up and open their eyes and be open-minded.
Well, everything says you're an animal. You're not made in the image of the Creator.
Right. Well, that's what they say. That's not the truth.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what me and my wife go over. We go over creation science and to prove that we are made in the image of God and that, I don't know. There's so much information. Like,
what do you make? Have you seen all the news where they tell Christians that they can't even be Christians or they give money to a Christian group, they'll be court-martialed? I mean, that's religious freedom in America. It's like Soviet Russia.
Yeah, that's just completely taken away from our Constitution. Like, what are we fighting for? We're fighting completely for them, you know. We're supposed to be fighting for this nation. We held up our right hand, and we swore to defend and protect it, and it just seems like they're just completely overriding it, and I just don't understand. Now, why don't we just...
Well, I feel sorry for all the people that don't know there's a spiritual battle going on. I snuck into Bohemian Grove. I've covered Skull and Bones. I grew up in Dallas, Texas, and saw amazing stuff going on. And the elite know there's the occult, and they have been given power over this world because they serve the God of this world. And it's totally real for them, and then they've convinced everyone that none of this is even going on. It's funny to them.
Yeah. On my website, I have a couple quotes that I've just that just come out of my mind sometimes on howiknow.com. And one of them, I don't know, you can check out Food for Thoughts. And the very last one, I don't know if I can read it. Tyrannical governments, authoritarian false religions, aliens from outer space, the theory of evolution, immoral living, music, and movies are all different books written by the same author, Satan. You know, that's just...
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, out of all the folks I met at the rally, they were all great, but I really just wanted to get you on the show. And then I saw your art. It was amazing. Tell us some about your art, because it's very diverse.
Yeah, well, I talked to a person a curator for art museum,
a conservator, a curator.
Curator, yeah, and she said that I have stylized design, abstract, and landscape. Those are what I do, and those are the styles that I use. And my art started with just hanging some stuff up in my house, and I didn't want to pay for it. And so I had people come over and they're just like, wow, that's really some really nice stuff. And I was like, well, you want to buy it? You know? And it's just snowballed into that. That's not.
Yeah. What we're showing is good, but the stuff we had up last time, I guess you've already sold all that. It was like all the trees and stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, I like that. But it was like trees with like blue trees with red background.
Yeah, that's the copper forest. That's right there to the left. No, the other one. Yeah, not that one. That one's fire forest.
I like that.
That one, if you go to the right, keep on going. Right there, that's the copper forest. I sold, one big one and one small one of those.
I like that one. Maybe I should get you commission one of those for the office. I like how it's in three panels, too.
Definitely.
So were you a painter before you were injured?
Yeah, my mom had a book, and it had so many different things I've done all my whole life. And it seems, I guess, after the ID, I kind of lost some of those memories, but it seems like I've been doing it my whole life, so...
Amazing. Well, Army veteran Mario Lopez is here in studio with us. Paintings by MarioLopez.com, but he doesn't even really want to talk about that. He's really talking about his site, howiknow.org. I'll give folks my take on creationism when we come back.
We're on the march. The Empire's on the run.
All right, I'm going to go to your phone calls. They're all over the map, but you can also address any questions to Mario Lopez, a veteran. The U.S. Army in Iraq and then Afghanistan. He was in a combat engineering unit and was pinned after a 300-pound improvised explosive device for at least 5 minutes while he was conscious under it and burned and lost his arm and an eye and other parts of his body. But his human spirit shines through, and he's here with us today. And he has had an experience that other cultures that aren't even Christian... And now they've been able to translate the Sanskrit and all the other different hieroglyphs. This is the experience people have. This is what goes on when you die. There have been so many atheists and people that have died and then been resuscitated to become Christians. And I don't mean establishment Christian. That's totally taken over and is like the system putting itself in front of that. But there are things we don't know about in this universe. I'll tell you right now. And the people running things know it. And are obsessed with it and are programming us with symbols. And whether you believe what David Icke believes or you believe what people like myself believe, there is something out there that there's a lot of unseen out on this planet in space. We only see a very small spectrum of what's going on. And I want to go to your phone calls, but I want to be able to give us his view on creationism. You know, people always ask me, what is my view on this? Here's the issue. If you go back about 180 years ago, the establishment wanted to discredit Christianity and bring in their occult systems that were even older. And so they made it, oh, you're not scientific. And then in the last 100 years, they would do fake Piltdown Man and fake cavemen, proving the missing link over and over again with fraud, just like global warming, all the rest of it. A lot of fraud in establishment science. To say we're just animals, to say there's no soul, to say there's no spirit, because if you don't know there's a war going on for your decision in this universe, which side, even if you're like, want to call it New Age, you believe in light or darkness. I'm trying to just quantify this down. Because the preachers want to beat people over the head with it and make it about whatever, you know, religious group you're in, and only their Christian group's the one that's the good one. That's meant to keep everybody divided. It's another tool of the devil, in my view. But the Bible talks about, you know, other creations and things destroyed before, you know, Adam and Eve and all of that. So I don't debate the real age of this planet. I don't debate all these other things that are going on. A day was as a year was as a day. It says in Genesis, you know, how God chooses to describe how the planet was built. It's darkness. And then God creates, you know, out of the void, new things, and then the light. And then you go to the science. That's basically, you know, gestalt how it was done. And so much of what was science fact 20 years ago, now they admit isn't true. So many genetic engineers now become religious because they can go and see the design in it. And the claim that out of a bunch of sand or water, cells were thrown together that are a billion times more complex than a fine Swiss wristwatch. Are you going to find a fine watch in the Sahara that wasn't made by someone because over enough time sand blew together to make it? Look at Prometheus. The elite actually, and I did a video on this on the review of Secrets of Prometheus Revealed, where they believe, I forget the exact scientific name of it. I think it's transpermia or whatever. But the point is that we were seeded by master. Say it again. Panspermia. That we were seeded by aliens. Well, see. I mean, even the scientists now are going, it's aliens. Evolution isn't possible the way we say. I'm not saying things don't breed, things don't change, cars don't evolve, people don't change, people don't, you know, develop certain traits. That's certainly there. But the lie of Darwin, who was an occultist, who said he was given his knowledge by dark angels. See, that's an interesting thing. The theory of Darwinism is like he saw an angel in a near-death experience. Darwin actually said that entities gave him his knowledge. And it's totally wild. His whole family set up eugenics that Hitler came out of. So see, people don't really know where Darwin comes from. He's like this icon god when he's really just a Malthusian. If you don't know who Malthus was, look it up. So I've given you some background where I stand. I believe it's all a false debate. Clearly, the official stories we're told about how old the Earth is and about how things work have been proven wrong. Even top scientists admit, no, things just show up on the developmental line suddenly during times of incredible mutation, but they can't ever find the mutation. So that's what's going. Clearly, this was designed. Clearly, this was built. And clearly, it didn't grow even out of space rocks that had microbes in them. Okay, folks, this was engineered. This was engineered. And now all of the atheist people are now saying it's aliens. Well, then you're not even atheist, are you? You just are people that say we're not allowed to have a debate about this when all the ancients in every culture said angels came here. That's where humans basically come from. Well, that's what the Bible says. And it says that there were angels coming down and basically having sex with women, the Nephilim. And that there were genetic abominations created, and then a cleansing. And then now look at the genetic engineering today. Look at what the elite do, trying to destroy all the creation. And that Noah was the only one who had perfect in his generations, not in his behavior. He got drunk and stuff and ran around naked and got made fun of by his kids. The point is he was perfect in his genetics. So it's archetypes to explain this to us. Now, I've given my view. I'm going to give you the floor now for about 5 minutes to give your view on creationism and also point out you go and speak for free at churches and give your testimony that I think is very important. If folks want to contact you at howiknow.org and paintings by Mario Lopez.com. But give us your take on creationism See, because I disagree with how some of the preachers, they describe what creationism is, and then that, and then we're supposed to listen to them or the Darwinists. No, how about I go read the Bible, I decide what I'm really seeing there. Go ahead.
I believe in the six-day creation. It's very explainable in the Bible. And, six-day creation.
What about my position? Because I'm saying I don't know. I believe the Bible, and I'm saying they've created a fake debate by men, the preachers, with the scientists in a fight, making it about them. Yeah. When the eye has not seen, the ear has not heard the things of God.
I think you're talking about whenever they believe in the gap theory. I think that's what you're talking about. The gap theory doesn't really mesh well with the Bible, because then you can leave in room for evolution.
But I think the way to attack their evolution theory is to point out they admit it's all crud now. I mean, they still teach school kids it's a fact.
Yeah.
But if you look at it, it isn't the way they've said. I mean, their theory is wrong.
Yeah, there's Heckler's drawings. I think it's Heckler. They have these primordial. They have these. I don't really. My wife is the one that talks.
She's a biologist. Yeah,
she's a biologist. You know, they had these drawings that they tried to explain how we all come from single cell organism, and mm-hmm. we take the same steps, like a human takes the same steps as a duck or whatever. Well, they've proved that since the 1850s, and they're still in textbooks in some form today.
No, that's the thing. At actual science level, they admit the whole thing's a fraud, and they believe space aliens did it. That's what most biologists and scientists now believe. I mean, they'll say somebody brought this here. It's a master engineer. But still, they teach, as you said, 150-year-old crud to school kids.
Yeah. Oh, well, this whole deal with aliens, they're demons, you know?
Well, exactly. I'm not saying I agree with that. I'm saying...
Oh, yeah, I know.
In real academia, they've had to admit it's all pure bull.
Yeah, they turn it into, well, it's not fact. It's a philosophy, and it's just a way of looking at things, and then their whole theory breaks down.
Yeah. I'm saying the Bible manifestly proves that it's accurate and is revelation. But then people have ancient interpretations of it that are interpretations of men. We then take those on as the real spiritual interpretation. When I look at it, take Revelation. There's no way somebody 2,000 years ago on an island came up with that without divine inspiration.
Right.
You read it, it's what's actually happening.
Right.
But then they'll argue, well, that's self-fulfilling prophecy. The elite have taken this plan. Well, regardless, it's being manifest.
Yeah, it's nothing that you can't change it. It's going to happen, you know. So we can really do is just warn people and try to point them to the Christ, you know. That's all we can really do.
Well, it's amazing hearing your story about the near-death experience. And Dr. Craig Roberts, well, there's Dr. Paul Craig Roberts, the economist, and there's Colonel Craig Roberts, my friend. But, you know, he talks about dead for 10 minutes. Bled out on the table in a stomach surgery for cancer. Dead. They'd gone. They walked off. It was like, you know, zip him up. He's dead. Declared dead. 10 minutes. You know, stopped resuscitating for like 4 or 5. Trying to resuscitate, and just the whole 9 yards.
I think they call that that medical phenomenon the Lazarus effect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I mean, atheists have it. And they go, well, it's your brain trying to sort things out. No, it's you're taken to a portal. There's hell right there, heaven right there. He's brought right up to, like, the decision point of the portal. And literally, he was given, and this happens to a lot of people, here's all this data. When he came back, he was so much smarter. He understood things. He was given discernment. And literally, just like in the TV shows and stuff, you know, because they archetype that, literally sent back with a mission.
Yeah, yeah.
Just imagine we're on this planet in space, and there's this whole interdimensional war going on all around us. Of course, we're an incredible creation. And there's incredible missions we have in the future. And literally, God is deciding, you know, is literally getting his people in this test. This is a real free will test. Because God's got to give free creatures. See, the angels only have, I guess you'd call it semi-free will. It's very complex, but then we have free will. We are made in the image of God.
Right.
And so we have to be given the free will. That's why God puts us through all of this.
Yeah, it's like if you want someone to love you, you can't make them love you, you know? And that's what this whole thing is about. You know, it's about, are we going to love God? And then whenever I visited hell, I accepted it. I knew I deserved to be there.
Was that in the first experience like this or the second? Describe the first experience and we're going to calls.
Okay. First experience, a little bit more traumatic. But
you don't have to talk about it if it's hard to talk about.
No, I can talk about it. I stand up in front of people and talk about it. But think I overdosed one night. I remember taking a lot of pills, and as I could feel my heartbeat slowing. And
this is after you've been injured.
This is after I've been injured. I could feel my heartbeat slowing and my breath not being as strong, and just thinking, wow, you know, you could die tonight. And I was like, you took a lot of pills. And just, well, I told myself, well, you deserve to go to heaven after everything you've been through, after everything you've done for your country. You know, I had this false thinking that my good works could get me into heaven, you know. And so I fell asleep. When I fell asleep, it was like I saw myself in my spirit. And it was like if you blow out a candle, you know how the smoke rises in when you blow out a candle, the smoke
yes.
is like that. That's what my spirit looked like. And my spirit started traveling down instead of up. And I was like, uh-oh, you know, this ain't good. And I traveled through Earth and I saw this orange pinhole of light. And I got closer and closer and closer to it.
Dimensional gate.
Yeah, and as I got closer, I could feel the heat. And then next thing you know, I smacked down to the middle of hell. And I fall inside a house with no roof. And there's a hurricane of fire going on the outside when the house is tumbling like tumbleweeds in the hurricane of fire. And then I saw some creatures in there. And I saw a woman levitating on an altar. And she looked what you would think what a witch looks like. She had black sackcloth as a garment. And she had missing pieces of white hair. And she was very veiny. She looked like she was 150 years old. And she was just levitating. And these creatures, this one, he looked like a gargoyle. He just pulled me without even touching me to this lady. And then I woke up. But while I was there, the same exact time while this happened so quickly, I felt three things. There was the only three things I was allowed to feel because I'd probably be dead right now. I felt hate. The hate was like a tangible thing. It was like you could bottle it if you wanted to. You could cut it, the hate, with a knife.
And that's the thing about the New World Order. They hate us. They come to kill, steal, and destroy. People go, why do they do all this? They hate people, especially children. Innocent, sweet little children. They want to torture the hell out of them.
Go ahead. They're in the image of God, that's why.
That's right. Yeah, that's exactly right.
And I felt the hate. And, I mean, people can feel hate when you walk into a room. If there's a bunch of people that don't like you, you can feel the hate sometimes. Well, this is like a million times over. And And like I said, you could bottle it if you wanted to. It's like a tangible thing. And then I felt the heat. And I know what being on fire feels like. I know what heat feels like on Earth. And I was underneath, you know, the debris for 5 minutes. The heat was like an acid in hell. On Earth, it's like, it looks the way it feels. It hurts here, it hurts here, it hurts here. You know, difference. You know, as the flames, you know, the little flames, you know, go up, and that's how it feels. But on Earth, but in hell, it feels like acid. It's just like all over my body all at the same time. And then I felt the hopelessness. The hopelessness,
that's why they like to torture children for long periods. They like to create hell on Earth. The baby being helpless, the 3, 4, 5-year-olds, their favorite, begging for mommy, that's what they like.
Yeah, and the hopelessness was like, I can attribute it to like drinking chlorine or something. If you were to drink a gallon of chlorine, you know, this is over. This is it. You know, you're going to die. Or I could attribute it to if you were to get stopped by a police officer and you got a pound of marijuana and, you know, something like that. Like with, you see the headlights, like that's what the hopelessness feels like. You know that there's no way out.
Incredible. We're going to go to break and do a little bit of overdrive. I promise we're going to go to Savish in Finland. And then next up will be Sergeant X. We're going to get to Dan, Carolyn, and Travis before the show ends. Any other points you want to make on that?
No, I just want to encourage if you're a pastor at a church or if you're in a leadership position, for the listeners out there, to give us a call, check out our website, and find out what we're about. And
this is what people need to be hearing in churches all day, not about how to do what the church says and give them more money. And these guys all, it's just so fake. And then they give like Homeland Security messages that I know the government gave them. Those preachers, I'm telling you, are not going to, they're going to go, God, I served you. And they're going to go right into hell. And I hope they're all listening and watching out there right now. Because I can tell you right now, these preachers betraying people and making these churches where it's all just to feel good and everything. And they're not out there fighting the evil of the world. They're not out there pointing out the devil's real. This is real. You need to make the right decision. If you're not hearing that, folks, hell and damnation speeches, then you know you're not in the right church.
Yeah, Jesus spoke more about hell than anything, really, you know, than heaven, you know. So.
Well, and I'm not up here on some high horse here judging people either. I've got a wicked streak a trillion miles wide, but my love of justice in God is unlimited. And I know good and evil, folks, and I know it's real. And people better get that through their head. People better understand that. We're going to be right back with your phone calls. I appreciate folks holding. Savage from Finland. Get it up next. I'm Alex Jones. We're going to do a little bit of overdrive, obviously, to take your phone calls here. And look, even if you don't believe in God and the devil or good and evil, there are good forces and bad forces in this universe. You know, there's energy, whatever you want to call it. And I'm not trying to be new agey here. I'm just trying to get people to understand there's a lot going on. And the state is not God. Hollywood is not God. It is a facsimile. It is something wanting to control our perceptions and take our free will. And it is evil by every stretch of the imagination. They tell you, oh, there's no good or evil. That's so you don't have any gauge of what's going on. Let's take some phone calls. Savish in Finland, you're on the air with Army veteran Mario Lopez. Go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Hey, buddy.
How are you, Alex?
I'm fine. Thanks for calling in and holding while we had our guest on. You want to talk about Obamacare?
Well, yeah. Well, actually, I had a few points before going into that, if you don't mind.
Sure, go ahead.
Well, first of all, I heard like a few weeks ago you talked about like people who wanted to affect this system and wake people up at the same time. And I've actually thought of this myself, and I'm actually thinking of getting involved in Finnish politics and going for the Congress in Finland.
Well, that's the answer. Good people need to run for office, maybe mayor first or water district head or something. But it's also good to aim high. But everyone should run for office who loves liberty, and then we would overpower the system if we just got up off our butts. I agree. That's a good idea.
Yeah, and also, I was like, a few times I've heard you saying that you're a weak person. Do not ever say that, because you're one of the strongest persons I know of. You're like, the courage that you have of taking upon these scumbags, these Obamans, and these globalists, you have a, like, you're not weak at all. You shouldn't say that at all, ever.
Well, I know that, but at the same time, I feel like I should do more. I mean, I have all these ideas and things I could do, and then I just run out of energy, and then I can't, by like 6, 7 at night, I can't make the right decisions and get tired. It's frustrating to see the enemy coming down on you and not being able to move them. I mean, we've had a bunch of victories, but it's just still, it's very frustrating to watch them get away with all this. What do you think of our guest testimony?
Well, I think that it's amazing what he's talking about, because the thing is that I myself completely believe in extraterrestrials and that like human life evolved with their help. And like whenever you look, like wherever you look, I mean, in the historical sites, you can see paintings of aliens and stuff. Like, for example, I'm Persian, so I know Persian history. For example, Zatoshtian history. It's a religion where they like where they keep fire as holy, and the symbol of Zatoshtian, it's like a bird thingy with a man inside it.
Sure, you're talking about the Zoroastrians?
I have no idea how it's pronounced. It's
sure. I got to jump because that's the end of this hour. But see, there's the issue. I see that, and God bless you, sir. I see that as the first step. See, the atheists, and of course, we really know they're cult leaders. They don't want people even thinking that there's something outside. It's all just boring. The planet's nothing. You know, there's nothing spiritual. There's nothing we don't know. It's at least one step for a lot of the atheists now to admit that evolution is a fraud and something built this. See, I see that as positive, what he was just saying.
Yeah.
Even though you would say, and I would say, those are fallen angels. Those are manipulators.
Right. Yeah. I agree with that. They're demons, and you know.
Why do you think they want to destroy us?
Because they hate us. They hate us. Like that's the bottom.
Because we're made in the image of what cast them down.
Right.
Yeah. That's pretty heavy. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Army veteran Mario Lopez joins us. Paintings by MarioLopez.com, howiknow.org. We're taking your phone calls. And you were making some points about Project Bluebeam, the government's admission of...
Blue Book.
Well, there was Blue Book and then Bluebeam.
Oh, okay.
But no, you're right, Blue Book on the whole UFO phenomenon. And repeat what you said, because that reminded me of that.
The Air Force General said that they were... that the spacecrafts were mesospherical, which I believe the definition is spiritual. That these entities that were driving these vehicles could not withstand those G forces and would be completely smashed.
Yeah, in our gravitational field, one millionth of it would smash them up against the wall like a pancake. The gravitation,
right?
And I mean these things are going 50,000 miles an hour, making right angle turns.
Right.
And so that's the whole point, is that it's not of this dimension.
Right. They're interdimensional craft, and they somehow get some sort of energy, and they are able to come into our dimension and have us see them, and just so they can deceive us. They're the great deceivers of this world.
Is it like... It's almost like a science fiction book. It's like a military interdimensional force that wants our soul that's in this Earth suit. It wants to suck that out.
Yeah, I've heard someone. I don't believe this, but I heard someone say that that they use our energy as fuel and as food. I don't know, but yeah.
Maybe that's why it's like being burned, because they're like sucking you dry. Is that what they're saying? I never get into all this stuff. The point is, the elite are obsessed with it, and it's very interesting to just see how similar the Bible is to all the science fiction. But then they're like saying, "Oh, but the Bible has nothing to do with it. It's all discredited and everything." But then it just fits into the whole cosmology, and then the establishment is obsessed with it. I mean, if you look at Skull and Bones, they believe they're worshiping fallen angels at Skull and Bones.
Yeah, they believe that they're worshiping the real God, like, because they've been deceived and it's like Luciferianism. They've been deceived in thinking that their God is really the right God, and you know, which is, and then they got all the symbolism and.
But look at the fruits of these people.
Right. Yeah. What are the fruits of it? And I have a quote on my
website,
on my website, the How I Know, and on Food for Thought. It talks about figuring out the attributes of God. Like if you see a butterfly is beautiful for no reason, or snowflakes, every single snowflake.
You recognize God's goodness.
Right. He's love. And all these other religions and all these other takes on and views, they don't match up with what we see in nature.
And then everything the New World Order produces is horrible, painful, you know, just horrible. The fruits of the New World Order are death.
And what I think is, if there was a creator out there, which there is, you know, Jesus, he would make a way for him to speak to us. You know, he would make a way for us to have communication with him, and then he would explain the stuff that we're not supposed to do. And then these people are just sitting there just believing the stuff we're not supposed to do, which is, you know, believing in Lucifer and Satan and stuff.
Wow. The God of this world. We're going to go to break. I promise, go quickly to Sergeant. Then we'll go to Carolyn, Dan, Travis, and Alex. And that'll be it for this original transmission. I am your host, Alex Jones. Websites are Infowars.com. You see the nightly news by subscribing to PrisonPlanet.tv. And so much of the news we don't get to hear is on the nightly news at PrisonPlanet.tv, 7 o'clock weeknights, with our great reporters and crew and researchers and all of you out there supporting us. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back on the other side of this quick break. Well, we have a man who runs the website, howiknow.org, paintings by Mario Lopez.com, Army veteran Mario Lopez, who survived a harrowing brush with death being blown up inside an armored vehicle, a 300-pound bomb, and being burned inside for more than 5 minutes, 5 minutes that he was awake. But he's here to tell about it and give his testimony to warn others. And, again, I'm not judging anybody out there. If you've had abortions or whatever, now you admit it's wrong or whatever, you can go out and warn others. It's just this is a culture of death that wants to hurt people, and the system is deceptive and wicked. And the fruits of the New World Order are death, regardless of what you think's behind it. We've got to say no to this. It's not good. It isn't taking us to a good place. Sergeant X wants to talk about possible false flag in Atlanta, and actually have articles that I forgot to get to that have just broken on Infowars.com the last 20 minutes or so, dealing with people panicking over these drills. Panicked Iowans fear losing power during blackout drill. Obamacare down, blame the hackers. Nemo's got an article out. They're now blaming imaginary hackers. Seattle Wi-Fi spy network has not been deactivated. That's big news that they lie to the public again. NSA snooping takes down U.S. computer network businesses. And the $1 billion TSA chatdown program, a complete failure. That's up on drudgereport.com. Trans-Pacific Partnership ready for Christmas delivery. World government, I mean, it's all happening. Let's go back to phone calls here. Sergeant X, you're on the air. Thanks for holding. Go ahead.
Can you hear me, Alex?
Hey, buddy. Yes, sir.
All right. Good to talk to you. First-time caller, four-year listener. I want to give a shout-out to my brother there, Mr. Lopez. I understand what you do. Appreciate what you're doing. Keep it going, brother.
All right. Thank you.
What I want to talk about real quick, man. I've been in for quite a while. Just recently got out, been in spec ops pretty much the whole time. A few things, that's why I've not identified my name. But nevertheless, when we went to, I don't hear this mentioned a lot, we went to clean up Hurricane Andrew in 92. In the 82nd, we were told to remove our patches. Beware of that. You don't want to identify it as regular Army. That's something that's pretty standard, I guess, nowadays. I didn't go to Katrina. Second thing, what these guys are doing in the military, mainly the brass, are telling the younger soldiers that, you know, you got to, you took an oath to, against any enemy, foreign, domestic. What they're making the younger guys believe is that the terrorists, which are myself, Mr. Lopez, and yourself, Mr. Jones, are the domestic terrorists. That's what
exactly they spin it, and they go enemies foreign and domestic, and then they say patriots who are just pro liberty that we're the terrorists, when enemies foreign and domestic means people like Obama, who is overthrowing the country. That's clearly the domestic usurper. So enemies foreign and domestic, they're flipping. In fact, that's what I've been told. So they're, from what you know, they're teaching them, oh, enemies foreign and domestic, teaching them they're supposed to operate domestically against the American people.
Exactly. They're saying, you know, these guys are going to stand up, their militia, you know, this, that, and the other. They're the domestic ones when, you know, it's just a brainwashing technique. And I'm sure Mr. Lopez there knows exactly what I'm talking about. The next thing, well, the main reason why I called, I have a brother that's a fellow ranger, and he's recently got out looking for jobs, so on and so forth, as we all do. He's a pretty good-looking fella. He's been doing some stand-ins for acting, just not a real good actor, but he, you know, he's just doing a lot of stand-ins because of his physique.
A lot of soldiers I know are getting hired to do acting, but yeah, go ahead.
I sent you a link. There's a bunch of different sites calling in Atlanta area. This is the disturbing part, and the buzz is going around with all the actors in Atlanta that are really getting scared because he and I both are listeners, and he and I are waking as many people up as we can. But the buzz going around, this is, and I actually read it for myself because, you know, I verify everything, even things that you say. They're looking for paramedics. They're looking for Army personnel, active or out, firemen with their own attire. Like I said, paramedics, they're looking for military in or out. They're looking, this is the disturbing one, they're looking for amputees for something coming up in Atlanta. They're not announcing what it is.
And for those that don't know, they'll have a real bomb go off, blow up a couple people, but then have amputees and people for a drill, splatter fake blood on them, and then they get confused and they go, well, it was a drill. It just so happened to happen. In fact, we know this was going on at Boston. Then they cover up the drill in the news, but we were able to get it documented and found news where they admitted weeks before they were having a drill that day. And then it confuses and conflates the whole thing. And then they tell them, well, for national security, you know, you're going to be arrested if you tell anybody about this. And we know that's going on. Is that basically what you're saying?
Exactly. And he knows not to participate in any of it, but he's warning all the others, don't participate in any of this, especially if you're in uniform. You work for a paramedics.
And listen, they could tell you show up with your own stuff, blow something up and say you did it. See, that's how this works, folks. We know the 7/7 bombers were like pretty much secular Muslims who were trying to get better jobs. The government said, well, be part of this drill. We know there was a drill. And some of them figured it out and ran. They gunned them down the street, covered that up, but it did come out in the news. Just incredible. It's not saying there aren't some real terrorists out there, but the whole issue is they script these events. And it doesn't mean that just because they're trying to hire thousands of people for some drill, that it couldn't be a real drill. Most of the drills are real. But then some days they have a drill, and that's when the staged event happens. Send us at showtips@infowars.com, Sergeant X, or whoever else is out there, these links to them trying to hire people for this drill. Because we've found a bunch of other stuff they're doing, very similar things that look very suspicious. Thank you so much, and God bless you. Sounds like, Mario, you're saying you've been a little bit involved in research of false flags. Did you connect anything he was just saying?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, like I was looking up the stuff with the Boston bombing, and I was actually, me and my wife traveled down to Missouri for my father-in-law's birthday, and where the World Series was going on, and there was a DHS drill that they announced on the local news. And so I actually emailed y'all to let y'all know, but I don't know what happened.
And again, they might have 400 drills that are normal, but also to demonize whoever the target is. It's always like a domestic group that's the bad guy, so it's brainwashing. But then they'll have the real event. We just seen they always run a drill as their cover. So if their operatives that are 1% of the drill, a small team, get caught, I'm part of the drill.
Yeah.
Russians do the same deal. And you also fund the terror attack through the drill as well. That then launders it so that the intelligence agency spying don't know what's happening. Let's go ahead, or it cloaks it, I should say, instead of launders it. Carolyn in Idaho, you're on the air. Thanks for holding. Welcome.
Good morning, Alex. I want to tell you how much I appreciate you. And Mario, I want to thank you for taking the oath and everything you've done to help keep me and my family free. I want to bring up the point about the Seattle City Council saying that they didn't know about the surveillance being on. And there was an article from when the police chief resigned last May about how he was happy to have innovation in place and how... a city councilman, Tim Burgess, who was running for mayor, and I don't know if he was elected, said Diaz was too slow to adopt the strategies for preventing crime by the DOJ.
That's right. They're putting federal pre-crime systems in that grab all your data illegally, and then they turn it on when they're not supposed to, and then they say they're turning it off and don't. Again, it's a culture of pure deception against us. I mean, you would be less deceptive to a foreign enemy. I mean, this is just, they just, as a rule, they're changing the culture towards total fraud.
So that brings up the point that the city council already knew about this being in place.
Oh, of course. The cops, the council, they're all going to play dumb. until it blows over. I mean, that's what I'm saying. They're all just a bunch of federal minions, and the feds themselves are run by globalists. Send us that article at Show Tips. God bless you. Thank you very much. Let's talk to Dan in Texas real quick. Let's skip this network break. We're going to go to the bottom of the hour. If you can hang, you've been in here for over an hour. Can you do it?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll skip this network break, go to the bottom of the hour. Dan in Texas, go ahead. You're on the air.
Alex Jones?
Yes, sir.
Hey, unbelievable that I got through. My question is, or actually a comment, I serve as the vice president on a board of directors of a credit union.
Yes, sir.
That's medium size. And my wife is a bank manager of a little, you know, we're only in about five counties at her bank. But the point is, you know how they hide things in plain sight?
Yes.
Like National Geographic put on that American blackout, we've got this drill. All right, the issue is all these NSF, these weird posts. My wife and I were having lunch. She goes, man, I'm having all these weird posts on people's accounts. In other words, money's disappearing. Money's like, it's just weird. So I called the manager of the credit union that I happen to be, you know, on the board of directors. And I just ran it by, hey, you got anything weird going on with your posts? Anything going on with the customers? And she verified it, too. So, I don't know. By way of heads up, you know, when one hand shows, look over here. But really, this is what we're really doing. I don't know if they just shut some things down to put something in and fire it back. You know what I'm saying? How does this happen, like Cyprus and other things, like you warned us? And now all of a sudden my wife out of the blue says, man, we got all these weird posts, this NSF charges, and people have their money. So, you know.
Yeah, that's what's happening. And here's an example, like flash trading. They hook computers in right there at the stock exchange that just steal money by doing these flash trades that they control. Total fraud. And then, yes, that's the new move. They're getting all the laws changed or regulations, totally illegal, quietly to just start taking your money. But the word is, and I've been told this for several years, it's been happening, they will grab money out of your account only for a few hours, but they'll do this to hundreds of millions of accounts worldwide, pool it, make deals with that money, and then put it back in your account. So, again, it's all digital. It's all fraud. And, I mean, what type of weird, you're just weird fees, weird, seeing stuff she's never seen before?
Right. Like, we had money in there, but we had an NSF posting on our account. She goes, what in the world is that? So I'm just asking, or perhaps
you're listening. And explain what an NSF posting is.
Non-sufficient funds. It's like something tried to go through, but no money was there at the time. And so there's a charge automatic that nobody can do nothing about it. You have to manually go in there and fix it if it was.
Yeah, well, this is happening to everybody I know, especially old people, because they've done actuaries test and know that they're not as savvy. Every old person I know on phone bills, cable bills, gas bills, credit cards, are being given fines and fees that aren't true. And they found most people just pay it. So it's a culture of evil. Send us intel on that. Send us show tips for other folks in banking. We'll try to get a story out on it. But thank you so much. This is what it's like, Mario Lopez here in studio with us, to live in a culture of evil. That's why third world countries can't operate. Because it's just the system's corrupt. Everything collapses.
Yeah, it's like back on that the bill thing. I've had AT&T multiple times. I call them up and I'm like, hey, what's up with this bill? You know, and like, oh, it's nothing. Sorry about that. We'll give you a month free. You know, and I'm like, well, if I didn't call, I would have paid that, and you just swept it under the rug and nothing. Say anything about it. So yeah, they
almost everyone I know now pays tickets, and then they still put a warrant out and come and arrest you.
Oh wow.
I mean, it's just totally collapsing. They just don't care. It's all funny. And I tell you, society's just gonna start unraveling. It's never been this complex. It's gonna unravel. They're gonna make it unravel. Travis in Washington, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, I got a couple things. Mr. Lopez, your aliens you're talking about were the ones that left their first estate. That were supposed to report back to God and watch over the people on this earth. They were also the gods of Olympus, the mythical gods. And that's all I got to say about that subject. I called in about the new cell phone spy network. Are you guys still there?
Yes.
Okay, it's not just for surveillance, Alex. You've seen the conspiracy theory with Jesse Ventura when he was up talking to Nick Begich. He put the suction cup on his forehead. And ELF waves were transmitted, and he heard exactly what.
Sure, no, they're putting in soft drink machines all over the world that beam audio directly into your brain, yeah.
Okay, Alex, that's what this is for. That's what this whole grid's for. Okay? So they don't need the serotonin reuptake inhibitors to turn you into a basket case or a Manchurian candidate no more. And that's all I got to say, guys.
You know, that is the thing. This whole system, DARPA admits they've been developing systems to manipulate us and make us submit the smart meters, all of it. I mean, we're living in a science fiction movie, Mario.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
No flesh would be spared if God didn't intervene. Let's take a call from Alex in Missouri. You're on the air. Thanks for holding.
Gentlemen, thank you both for your time. Mario, thank you for your service to this country. Alex Jones, thank you for your service to humanity. Wanted to ask a favor and give you a story. A friend of mine's daughter, my wife and I went back and forth about our daughter getting the HPV virus vaccine, and I was adamant that she not do it. Thank God I won that argument. My wife's friend now has a teenage daughter who was an avid gymnast. 2 years ago, received the shot. They didn't make the correlation to her sickness until she had gotten the second shot. And she's now in the fight of her life with chronic headaches, nausea,
lupus,
unable to do gymnastics. Oh, they're saying fibromyalgia, but
yeah, no, it's designed. Listen, here's what it is. On record, it sterilizes a lot of people, reduces fertility bare minimum, causes autoimmune disorder, and it is a bioweapon. And they're testing. Can we give somebody something that killed a bunch of people in the trials, and then test and see because the government gives them immunity where they can't be sued. Quietly, the government might pay it out. And this has killed now thousands of people worldwide. They're giving them to every Mexican girl in Mexico right now is being forcibly injected with this. You're not going to hear La Raza and Mecha talk about that. And I'm telling you, folks, it is unbelievable that this is going on. And it is a sterilant. And it's to test and see, can we maim and kill people and get away with it? And the answer is you can. So, of course, they're going to quadruple your payment on health care because they can get away with it. And the MSNBC is going to say your kids belong to us. And, I mean, this is evil. They are, and it's usually the second or third shot. And some people go in again and give them the third shot, and their daughter dies. They are so committed to those doctors, they actually kill their daughter. Now, in the old times, in Tyre, on the Mediterranean, they would throw a child into a burning pit. That was a loving way to sacrifice them to Satan compared to this. This is slow death. Your comments on talking about Gardasil. That doesn't even protect you from cancer or the warts, by the way.
I don't know. I don't really know too much about that. My kids were vaccinated, you know, normally, and they're fine, thank God. But it's just, they just getting away with it. And
they haven't taken Gardasil, have they?
I don't have no idea.
Well, they're going to push that on you. Just look into it.
Okay.
Believe me, if it wasn't true, they'd be suing me. I mean, look it up. Remember Rick Perry said it's the law and it wasn't the law, another hoax? And people said, well, you ought to like Rick Perry. Well, he needs to walk that back because, I mean, that's pretty evil right there. What is she going through there, Alex? Because I remember a case in actually Kansas City where a girl died from the Gardasil, but go ahead.
Well, if you Google Tyler's story of vaccine injury, you can read everything that's going on with her chronic headaches, nausea, fatigue. Again, she was a gymnast and she can't even practice gymnastics anymore. And the favor that I ask of you, Alex, for us info warriors out there, you know, when we try to spread the word and let people know about vaccines, about FEMA camps, about the things that you are putting out into the world, we have to go do that research and look for those things ourselves. And maybe on your website, you have a page, Info Warriors for Dummies.
I've said this a million times, and we're going to try to do it soon where we have data pages with all the facts, with all the stuff in one spot. God bless you. I appreciate you calling. Man, we're just out of time. We've got all these callers. We've got Max and Zach and Christy and Alex and everybody else, but I'm going to have to stop right there because we're out of time. And I wanted to plug one more time, howiknow.org, paintings by Mario Lopez.com, Army veteran Mario Lopez. While in Afghanistan in 2008, he witnessed the dark side of the military before his engineering unit ran over an IED in Afghanistan, which left him badly injured. Anything else that you'd like to add for folks out there in the minute or two we have left?
No, just like I said, again, encourage pastors if you have a congregation and you have some young people in it to let them hear the other side of it before they end up just fully totally falling into the New World Order system and just the lies that that they're being fed every day. Where these kids are going into battle at, you know, 6 years old. They're going into a battle that should be fought with people that are that know. They're just a sponge, just soaking up everything, and we just need to just stop laying down and letting other people, letting the Satan educate our children. And so if you have a church or congregation, just call us, see how to book us, and we'll just go from there.
Well, God bless you. The phone number is 361-207-2599 for folks that aren't on the internet, 361-207-2599. And God bless you. And we're going to end the show here in about a minute or two, so stay right there. We're going to go out and eat some lunch with you, some late lunch with you and your wife. Folks, every tweeny singer now is into Satanism on television, targeting girls under the age of 10. There is no doubt that we have just turned our children over to this. And I'm not on some high horse, but I mean, my goodness, protect their innocence. Realize that the globalists hate you. They hate your family. They hate us all. I mean, here's a plug at the end. Survival Shield Nation iodine, the best iodine out there for my research, what I choose for my family at InfoWarsLife.com. They know all the other halogens are bad for your thyroid and your body. They know in the major studies, Harvard studies about lesions in the brain from not having iodine and having fluoride instead. They know this. They don't tell pregnant women about quality iodine. They took the iodine out of the salt. They don't want you to know about this stuff. The people perish for lack of knowledge. InfoWarsLife.com. Purify your water with the ProPure water filters. 20% off promo code WATER20 at InfoWarsStore.com. Or you can call toll-free for InfoWars Life. Or for InfoWars Store at 888-253-3139. And it's your purchases that allow us to have this one-of-a-kind radio TV show to reach millions of people. So thank you so much for your financial support. And please keep us in your prayers. We'll be praying for you. Nightly news, 7 o'clock tonight, PrisonPlanet.tv.
We're on the march. The Empire's on the run.